Committee held a hearing on U.S.-Mexico anti-drug efforts. Testifying, officials from the Drug Enforcement Administration, General Accounting Office, and Bureau of International Narcotics and Law Enforcement Affairs. It's a three-hour hearing, which begins with remarks by the subcommittee chairman, John Mica.
We are going to go ahead and proceed. We have several other members who are tied up in hearings and will join us shortly, but pleased to welcome you this morning to this hearing entitled Oversight of United States-Mexico Counter-Narcotics Efforts. This morning I'll start our subcommittee proceedings by making an opening statement, yield to other members that are here. We will then hear from our witnesses, and we'll probably defer other opening statements since we've had a delay until after we've heard from our witnesses. I appreciate their indulgence. We did try to be tolerant of their other schedules this morning, but we must proceed. I'd like to again start with my opening comments. Again, a very serious topic, a serious situation that we're dealing with, particularly the problems of drugs coming in from Mexico. Drug abuse in America, especially among our youth, is at epidemic levels. The situation with international drug trafficking, I believe, is becoming a threat to our national security. Over 14,200 Americans lost their lives last year to drugs and drug-related crime at a cost of billions and billions of dollars, not to mention the cost to families and to others in distress that is caused by the use of illegal narcotics. Despite a long and productive relationship with our ally to the south, Mexico, the hard river of drugs that are ending up on America's streets are coming across from the Mexican border. Not only is Mexico the leading source of deadly hard drugs entering the United States, according to DEA's signature program, Mexico has now become a major producer of high purity heroin. If you wouldn't mind, let's hold this up here. This is a chart prepared on the source of heroin from 1997, and it shows Mexico is not only the major trafficker, but it shows that it is now becoming a major producer of heroin. The heroin that's coming into the United States, 75% is produced in South America, and our DEA administrator can elaborate on what's happening. But not only do we have the transiting of this deadly heroin through South America, we also have now production, and we can tell this very accurately by this signature program that can tell the source of heroin. Additionally, Mexico serves as the major source of foreign methamphetamine that's also ravaging our Midwest communities and the western part of the United States, and now spreading throughout the country. 50 to 70% of the cocaine on America's streets crosses our southwest border. This is a absolutely staggering figure, and a staggering quantity of drugs, again, all entering through Mexico. Additionally, Mexico is, as I said, one of the major foreign sources of methamphetamines. A recent article in the Minneapolis Star Tribune stated that about 85% of the methamphetamines in Minnesota is smuggled through Mexico. This is just a little quote from the Minneapolis Star Tribune in September of last year. Drugs coming from Mexico undermine our communities. They spread and finance gang violence, and in fact are destroying young lives in America at a record level. Heroin deaths among our young have nearly doubled in the past few years. These are innocent, often unsuspecting youth. In many cases, our young people are the greatest victims of this devastation being imported in large quantities, as I said, from Mexico. If nothing else, we should be concerned about our young people who are at the center of this whole issue. Congress, and I believe the subcommittee, owe them our leadership. The statistics on drug use, particularly among our young people, continue to be worrisome and should sober every American and every member of Congress. Heroin use is up a staggering 875% among our teens. Today, we should be appalled by the trends. Drug overdose deaths continue to plague our metropolitan areas, and not just our inner cities, but today our suburbs and our schools and almost every street in our communities. Drug use is highest among our 12th graders, with more than 50% of our 12th graders having tried an illicit drug, and more than one in four labeled as current users. Today, our subcommittee will examine Mexico's role in the fight against illegal drugs. Without question, no country in the world possesses a more immediate drug threat and national security danger to the United States. In an effort to fully examine this issue, we'll hear testimony from our DEA Administrator Tom Constantine and Randy Beers from the State Department's Bureau of International Narcotics and Law Enforcement Affairs. They'll be followed by the General Accounting Office, who will outline Mexico's counter-narcotics activities that they have taken over the last year. While some minor progress has been made against drug trafficking in Mexico, that country has, in my estimation, failed to live up to concerns expressed by Congress over 2 years ago. Despite some of the reports that progress has been made against drug trafficking in Mexico, Mexico still has not done the following things, and we talked about these, and the House passed a resolution 2 years outlining these things. Mexico still has not signed a bilateral maritime agreement. Corruption remains a major impediment. Additionally, United States drug enforcement agents are not allowed to adequately protect or defend themselves. Our agents still remain at risk. Mexico has failed to extradite a single major drug trafficker. What is even more troubling is that even money laundering that was discovered among Mexican banking officials and was revealed last year, rather than cooperate, Mexican officials threatened to indict United States Customs officers. Now, what is of great concern to me is that Mexico has lost vast land areas. In fact, they've lost entire states and regions to the control of narco traffickers. We have only to look at the Baja Peninsula and the Yucatan Peninsula for examples of areas completely lost to narco traffickers. Under the reports we have received, there are, again, complete areas under the control of narco traffickers. If this trend continues, Mexico could be on the verge of turning its sovereignty over to drug traffickers. It's difficult for me to believe that this administration would certify Mexico as fully cooperating if we just take a few minutes to look at what has taken place in the statistics. The statistics are and facts are indeed troubling. Some of the statistics from 1998 are absolutely startling. Boat seizures were down last year in Mexico 29% from 1997. This little chart are the basic facts as what took place between 1997 and 1998 relating to major seizures of hard drugs, opium, heroin, and cocaine. These statistics are mind-boggling. A reduction in heroin seizures of 56%, a reduction in cocaine seizures of 35%. These are issues that must really be faced and be at the top of our agenda today as we attempt to find solutions to this disastrous situation. We aren't here today to bash Mexico. We're here in an effort to find out what went wrong. Does the certification process work? And why is there such concern among our law enforcement officials and people on both sides of the aisle, Republican and Democrat? Sort of close with the comments of our minority leader, who said, after reviewing the past year's record, I am compelled to disagree with the president's decision to certify Mexico as fully cooperating with our government in the fight against drugs, and that was by Mr. Gephardt. So there is major concern on both sides of the aisle that this situation with Mexico may be out of control, that we may have indeed erred in certifying Mexico, and that we need to get a real handle on what's going on and how we can work as partners with Mexico to bring this situation under control. So with those opening comments this morning, I would like to yield to the ranking member of our subcommittee, Mrs. Mink, the gentlelady from Hawaii. You're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I wanted to first note that Chairman Micah and six other members of Congress have just returned from a very rigorous field trip to a number of countries: El Salvador, Panama, Colombia, Peru, Bolivia, and ending up with a three-day visit in Mexico City before returning to the United States via El Paso. We did make a brief stop initially in Miami also. And this trip certainly revealed to me the enormity of the trafficked problem that we are faced with. And the transit of drugs through Mexico was clearly evidenced in all of our discussions with our American officials and with the various country officials with whom we had the opportunity to meet. I come to this subject area rather new, perhaps naive in many ways about the nature of the trafficking and the amounts and the course through which they penetrate our borders. But it certainly was not with any lack of understanding of the scourge that this country faces in terms of the victims, mostly our children, in all of our communities who are affected by this drug trafficking. So we have a unique opportunity, I think, in this committee and in the Congress to focus attention on both the matter that is at hand today in this hearing, and that is the trafficking problem through Mexico, and the debate that will ensue with reference to the president's decision to certify, and others who feel that they are in disagreement with that decision. And the other part of the triangle with which I am very much concerned, and that is to what extent we in the United States are mounting as vigorous as a battle as we can in the law enforcement area. We have focused our attention on education and treatment and other matters, but it seems to me that we need to now turn, as we are doing, to other countries to determine exactly what we are doing in all of these areas that we are putting our penetrating view with respect to other countries, and that is in the area of detection, eradication, and penalty of the people that are responsible for the consumption of drugs by our constituents. So I look forward to the testimony this morning, Mr. Constantine and Mr. Beers. You will certainly add light to the information that we have at hand, and I look forward to the opportunity to propound a number of questions. Thank you very much.
Thank the gentlelady, and pleased to recognize the gentleman from Texas now, Mr. Turner, for an opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate the chair having this hearing today, coming from the state of Texas that shares a border with Mexico. We are in Texas, of course, proud of our cultural and economic ties to Mexico, but also uniquely aware of the law enforcement burdens that come along with the problems of the narcotics traffic across our border. We know and understand that the certification process is an awkward hammer and often difficult to use in a meaningful way. And we also, I think, in Texas appreciate the fact that it's often important to understand that those who generate the demand for drugs share equal in the burden of finding solutions with those who generate the supply. But I do think that as we have this hearing today, it's important, I think, for us to understand that as we pursue our mutual goals of trying to eliminate drug use and abuse and to increase our law enforcement efforts along the border, that we must do so with an understanding of the other national interests that we have with Mexico and the ties that have existed for many years that we want to preserve. So, Mr. Chairman, with that, I appreciate again you hosting this important hearing.
Thank the gentleman. I'm pleased now to recognize our two witnesses on our first panel this morning. We're privileged this morning to have one of the most distinguished law enforcement officers of the United States, Mr. Tom Constantine, who is our administrator of the Drug Enforcement Agency. We're also privileged to have an assistant secretary of the Bureau of International Narcotics and Law Enforcement Affairs of the Department of State, the Honorable Randy Beers, who's joined us. As you may know, gentlemen, this is in addition to having some authorizing ability in the national drug policy area. We are also an investigative and oversight subcommittee of Congress, and we do swear in our witnesses. So if you would please stand up, raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give before this subcommittee of Congress is the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you. Let the record reflect that the witnesses answered in the affirmative. And again, I'm pleased to welcome one of the most courageous law enforcement officers, one of the most respected gentlemen I've seen. He accompanied me right after I was named chair. We went together to a meeting in Europe in Baden, I believe it was, Austria, and met with officials from throughout the world, some of the drug czars, leaders, to begin my effort and renew his effort and others in this international war against illegal narcotics. I was so impressed with his comments, his presentation, and the respect that he has not only in this country but throughout the world in this difficult battle. So I am absolutely pleased and delighted that you are joining us today and look forward to your testimony and comments. You're recognized, sir.
Congressman, thank you very much for your kind comments, and to the other members of the committee, I have submitted a fairly lengthy document detailing our analysis of the organized crime drug problem, especially as it impacts the United States and as the command and control is in Mexico. And I would ask your forgiveness to have that as my official
Without
submission.
Without objection, that entire statement will be made part of the record.
Okay. Thank you. The central theme of that presentation concerns really how major organized crime syndicates are impacting the citizens of the United States and how the organizations that are based in Mexico have become so powerful in a relatively short period of time. All of the information that is in that report and in this presentation is based on a complete and very detailed analysis of every major narcotics investigation conducted by the DEA, which involves organized crime groups that are headquartered in Mexico. In addition to our own fact-finding and analysis, we've consulted with each of the federal agencies in the law enforcement community and the intelligence community, and we've also reviewed and discussed our analysis with all the major state, city, and local agencies throughout the United States. As a side comment, we have been watching with some degree of concern over the last 2 or 3 years a spread of the narcotics problem out of the rural or out of the urban areas of the United States into the rural and mid-sized cities. As a result, we brought together about 100 police chiefs, sheriffs, and prosecutors a little over a week ago to a hotel out by Dulles Airport. Prior to bringing them there, we submitted a fairly detailed survey form asking them to describe their narcotic situation in their city, county, town, or state. 68% of those who came and replied indicated that the nexus of their drug trafficking outside of their immediate area was organized criminal groups from Mexico. This was later then played out in a series of workshops, and eventually we will be putting together a report within the next month explaining all of the problems that these smaller and mid-sized areas that are suffering, often without the necessary resources. The analysis of the, and by the way, that chart there depicts all of those kind of a spread, as you can see, of these cities, villages, towns, and counties. Our analysis of the problem really has focused on how sophisticated criminal organizations based in another country, in this case Mexico, can commit massive criminal activity within the United States. At present, these syndicates, which are based in Mexico, in our opinion, in my opinion, pose the greatest drug trafficking threat to the citizens of the United States. As a result of some excellent investigations by federal, state, and local law enforcement, we now have a very clear picture of how these drug lords ship tons of narcotics into the United States, collect billions of dollars from United States citizens, and then at times arrange for the assassinations of either witnesses and or public officials in both Mexico and the United States. We have identified and in many cases acquired sufficient evidence to indict many of the key leaders of these organizations, but so far they have been able to evade arrest and prosecution. Like all organized crime systems throughout the history of the modern world, they've been able to succeed using traditional tools. Those tools are violence, intimidation, and corruption. Unfortunately, as I said last week before the Senate, as I testify on this issue of the problem and the impact on these organizations that are based in Mexico on the citizens of the United States, it has been interpreted by some as a criticism of the people of Mexico or the government of Mexico. Nothing could be farther from the truth. I have great respect for the citizens of Mexico, and I've met with a number of public officials who I respect equally. However, I have at several times in my law enforcement career taken an oath of office. I also administer that oath of office to new DEA graduates and at one time state troopers. And that oath requires that we protect the citizens of the United States. I take that oath very seriously. I've dedicated my life to it. At times, I've risked my life for those same principles. So our analysis on this problem is not based on criticism as Mexico, as much it's based on the fact that there are criminal organizations and drug lords who live there who are doing a great deal of damage within the United States. Their operations are fairly traditional. On any given day, probably as we're speaking here this morning, drug lords in Colombia and Mexico are involved in business transactions. the transactions that are involved with is that they communicate with criminal operatives that they have sent into the United States. These organizational operatives then arrange for the shipment and storage of tons of cocaine and hundreds of kilos of heroin and methamphetamine to be sold to our citizens. The criminal organizations based in Mexico have matured from being merely a transportation agency for the Colombian organizations to become the dominant threat to the citizens of the United States. An example of one case and one organization and one subset of that organization. It's a group that is driven or led by the Ariano Felix brothers out of the Baja area of California, Tijuana and Mexicali. They ship tons of cocaine into Los Angeles, Tucson, Chicago, Detroit, and Greensboro, North Carolina. We were fortunate enough in the investigation to see some of their records. We found that this one group in 90 days had shipped 10 tons of cocaine into the United States and taken $90 million in cash out of the United States back to their headquarters in Tijuana. Mention was made of methamphetamine. They not only control 50% of the distribution of cocaine, they found that they had a drug that they could manufacture from the beginning, which they did not have to share the proceeds with the criminal organizations from Colombia. We had a minuscule methamphetamine problem in this country until it was developed wide-scale distribution from these criminal organizations. To give you a sense of the growth and the explosion of that, in 1991, emergency room admissions in this country for methamphetamine were 4,900. By 1997, the emergency room admissions had gone to 17,400. In 1992, the seizures along our border with Mexico of methamphetamine were 7 kilos. In 1998, there was 1,400 kilos seized. So we've moved from small motorcycle gangs and relatively low-level usage to widespread distribution and manufacture from organized crime groups and distribution in the United States, and it spread from California to every state in the Union, except for, strangely enough, the Northeast Quadrant, exclusive of the Philadelphia area. To give you an example of the impact in the middle part of this country, in Des Moines, Iowa, there are now more methamphetamine arrests than there are drunken driving arrests. In Marshalltown, Iowa, and last year, a set of elected officials and teachers and police chiefs and sheriffs and county executives came to my office looking for assistance any place they could find it. A community that never had a drug problem now all of a sudden had a major methamphetamine problem. And they have a high school there. There's 1,600 students in that high school. Over one-third of those students have now tried methamphetamine. We have in the course of our investigation, found major laboratories that are run by these criminal organizations that are in and of themselves very dangerous. We find them that they build them and construct them in areas close to middle schools, in equestrian centers where young people are taking riding lessons, in all of them being driven by the heads of the criminal groups that are based in Mexico. There is an incredible amount of violence always associated with organized crime. These groups, like all of their predecessors, whether in the United States, in Italy, or Colombia, rely on violence as an essential tool of their trade. They use contract killers and brutal assassinations, and that's done for one reason, to intimidate the common citizen and to intimidate many public officials from providing witness information that is essential to arrest or prosecution. If these people are intimidated and do not provide us information, investigations will never be successful. It's not only limited to their activities as they occur in Mexico, we also are increasing experience, violence, and threats by these same groups against United States citizens and law enforcement along the border. I mentioned in the beginning of my discussion the fact that what we're really dealing with is a powerful organized crime syndicate, and that's the key to understanding our adversaries, and it becomes much clearer and our strategies for dealing with it become more direct. For the first 70 years of this century, the primary drug of abuse in the United States was heroin, and really heroin at a fairly low level of usage and low purity. Recently, in the presentation that Congressman Micah talked about, we did some research, and in Baltimore, in the mid-1950s at that point in time. The population was 949,000 people, and the number of heroin addicts was in the 300-350. The population of Baltimore is now 675,000 people, and there are 39,000 heroin addicts. So the city of Baltimore for a heroin problem has gone from one heroin addict for every 3,161 people in the 1950s to one heroin addict for every 17 people in the 1990s. That heroin traffic was driven by organized crime. I have a chart up here of what it looked like that. The nexus and the command and control was, for the most part, in New York City. Those of you who have seen the movie The Godfather or looked at some of the arts and entertainment reconstruction of organized crime development in the United States would be familiar with that. The source was Europe, the so-called French Connection. The major crime families would then arrange for the distribution of the heroin throughout the United States. And really, it was in the halls of Congress and in the Senate that finally we became aware and moved from a state of denial on organized crime to a recognition. The hearings held in the late 1950s, especially by Senator McClellan from Arkansas, were key in being able to explain to the citizens of the United States how serious this problem was. Interestingly enough, as if you go over those transcripts, which I have, you'll find that the chief counsel for those hearings was Bobby Kennedy. He then moved from there to become Attorney General and implemented the types of investigative prosecutorial strategies that were essential to dismantling organized crime. And we have done, I think, a tremendous job in reducing organized crime to what it is today. I watched television the other night. They depict organized crime as skinny Joe Merlino from Philadelphia as being the head of organized crime, supposedly in the United States, who will have little or no impact in anybody outside of South Philadelphia. But if you look and we see a change, the change occurs that despite those successes, as we move from cocaine, we now find out that the nexus for organized crime in the United States is based in Colombia. They decided that they did not need any criminal organizations in the United States to set up their distribution or money collection. They established what we call cell structures. They went to major cities. They dispatched thousands of their own employees into the United States. The high level were trusted people. The low level people filled out work forms listing all of their biographic data so that they dare not testify and they dare not cooperate. From there, they would collect the money and then they would distribute the drugs throughout the United States. They are still very powerful. There's still a great danger, but a great credit to General Serrano and the head of the Colombian National Police and his policemen, working with the DEA and other governmental agencies, they've been able to arrest all of the major organized crime figures and have now become very aggressive in a proactive fashion, despite major difficulties that they face today. The picture of organized crime has now changed again, and the change is that the groups from Colombia originally entered into what they thought was a business arrangement with the organizations out of Mexico, and the groups from Mexico would transport the drugs for Colombians into the United States and turn it back over to Colombians for distribution in much like the previous chart. It wasn't long before that changed. And now we see two parallel organizations in the United States for organized crime, one based in Colombia, one based in Mexico, the group from Mexico becoming increasingly stronger, the strength of the Colombian groups tending to be diluted over a period of time. So there are some parallels between our experience in the United States with the Mafia or La Cosa Nostra and today's syndicates in Colombia and Mexico. However, there are some differences. The amount of money that these organizations in Colombia and Mexico make, the impact on the communities and citizens of the United States, the violence and the corruption associated with these groups that we see today are nothing like we could have ever imagined in the 50s and 60s. They make the traditional organized crime or mafia in the United States look like grade school children compared to what they do. They have sophisticated intelligence systems, they have mansions, safe houses, planes, armored cars, security teams. encryption. They use encryption to try to deflect what we do in the investigation. The one thing that is constant and will always be constant in organized crime has been pointed out in every presidential commission and every congressional hearing. Organized crime cannot and will not exist without the collaboration of corrupted law enforcement officials who protect the criminals and condone criminal activity. I have a very elaborate report on the major crime families that are in charge of this narcotics trafficking in my submission. Many of the key leaders that you see in that report in these organizations have been investigated continually within the United States, and we have been able to secure sufficient evidence to indict them. All that we need to do is to locate them and arrest them and bring them back to face justice between a jury of the peers of the community and the people they've injured. I have privately and publicly thanked the Attorney General, Mr. Madrazo, from Mexico and his staff for their arrest this year of Jesus and Luis Amezcua. That was a very significant, important arrest. Unfortunately, the judiciary in Mexico has dismissed all of the criminal charges existing in Mexico. The only remaining charges are charges of investigations conducted in the United States, and we are still waiting for the outcome of the extradition process. The ability to deal with organized crime is, believe it or not, fairly direct. We've learned lessons over a period of time that these groups are not invulnerable. They can be dismantled. They're not held together by any political or religious philosophy. They're only held together by greed and corruption. We know that honest, hardworking law enforcement officers and prosecutors can prevail. We've seen it in the United States, we've seen it in Italy, and we've seen it in Colombia. I also know from experience that if they're left unchecked, these drug lords and organizations will only grow more powerful and dangerous to the citizens of the United States and Mexico. The level of corruption, the level of violence that we see that they impact within Mexico will be the same strategy that they use in the border states and increasingly the other states in the Union. Fairly, we have to recognize this as a long, difficult process. We have invested in the DEA millions of dollars and tremendous efforts on the part of DEA agents to develop cooperative relationships. However, honestly, these have had only limited success at present. Many of the joint ventures that we have established and begun to start have really been impacted by the fact that the traffickers are willing to spend hundreds of millions of dollars to corrupt law enforcement systems. In the past year, we've encountered a significant setback. The setback was a unit that a great deal of money was expended and energy into a special vetted unit so that we could share information in a sensitive basis for high-level targets. We now have found out that significant people at senior levels in that unit appear to have been corrupted, which is a major disappointment to both the government of Mexico and the United States. There are many varied opinions that you will hear on this, as I do. However, I believe there's one fact that cannot be challenged. That's that these major organizations, the leaders of these organizations, are inflicting tremendous damage on the citizens of the United States. I also have to tell you that they have become more powerful each and every year that I've held this job as head of DEA, and unfortunately, very few of them have been brought to justice. I'm often asked why I'm so serious about this issue and why I'm so direct. I believe it's important to note and to remember that every day and every night, we're asking thousands of young American law enforcement officers to go out and to risk their lives to protect me, my family, and all of us from the danger of these powerful groups. Over the course of a 39-year career in law enforcement, I've lost a number of friends, classmates, coworkers, and subordinates who have been killed in the line of duty. Often that requires you to sit down with a mother, a father, a husband, or wife, and try to, in the trauma and their grief, explain the significance of the loss. In the course of those conversations, I'm often asked, especially if it's related to narcotics, am I serious about this? Is the loss of their son, the loss of their daughter, the loss of their husband or their wife, sometimes a mother or father, has it been in vain, or are we committed to somehow continuing this battle against the individuals responsible? I tell them, I am serious, we are serious, we will continue with all of our energy. However, if there is a continued ability of the drug lords who are really causing these deaths to evade arrest, extradition, and prosecution, I think it makes it very, very difficult to reassure these families of our seriousness. So I thank you very much, Congressman.
Thank you for your testimony, and I'm pleased now to recognize the Assistant Secretary of the Bureau of International Narcotics and Law Enforcement Affairs of the Department of State, Mr. Beers. You're recognized, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of this committee. Thank you for this opportunity to testify before you on what is, as the chairman so correctly indicated initially, and Mr. Constantine has so much further indicated, a very, very serious problem, both to the United States and to Mexico. I have a longer presentation, which I would like to have submitted for the record.
Without objection, so ordered, it'll be made a part of the record.
Thank you very much, sir. We have been through a process, our certification process, which began in December and continued through until the President's announcement on the 26th of February. We had 28 countries to consider. Four were given national interest waivers, and two were decertified. We had 14 interagency meetings on this process at various levels. We had a unanimous recommendation of the four cabinet officials recommending from State, Treasury, Justice, and Defense, as well as senior White House officials. And the President then recorded their views and certified or decertified or provided national interest waivers to the countries in question. The basis under which we made those decisions comes from a law which you all have passed, and it states that we should determine that a country has fully cooperated with the United States or taken steps on its own to achieve full compliance with the goals and objectives of the 1988 UN Drug Convention. With respect to this language and the decision which we are asked to make under it, we have asked our lawyers to give us their views on that statute. And while the statute says fully cooperating, we have determined that this is not a rigid or unrealistic standard. First of all, achieving full compliance with all of the goals and objectives of the 1988 Drug Convention is an aspiration for all of our efforts, a goal that even the United States continues to pursue each year. As to fully cooperating, we look at several indications. First of all, we review the challenges facing a country. Then we ask ourselves whether the government has the ability to meet those challenges, whether the government is genuinely trying to meet the benchmarks that we jointly establish with them, whether the country's attitude toward fighting narcotics trafficking and the government's attitude towards fighting narcotics trafficking is adequate, and whether or not the government performance in light of the overall situation is adequate. It is on that basis that we make those decisions, and on that basis that the President determined that Mexico was fully cooperating. He recognized that Mexico faces serious, very serious problems: drug trafficking, transshipment, production, money laundering, and corruption. In addition to the President's decision, I would ask that we submit for the record letters from the governors of Texas, Arizona, New Mexico, and California, all of whom state that it is their belief that decertification would jeopardize existing and future anti-drug and law enforcement relations between these two countries, and indicating their full support for certification. I ask that these two letters be inserted in the record.
Without objection, they'll be made a part of the record.
Thank you, sir. This is not to say that we or the government of Mexico do not acknowledge, as Administrator Constantine has indicated, the very serious problems that do exist in Mexico. In a recent presentation, we, both governments, agreed on five major elements which very closely parallel Administrator Constantine's point. Serious crime in Mexico has nearly doubled in the past 7 years. That crime is more organized and more violent than ever before. Law enforcement agencies within Mexico generally proceed without adequate resources. Those same law enforcement agencies also lack training, equipment, adequate salaries, and are, as Administrator Constantine indicated, extremely vulnerable to corruption. In addition to that, the courts also represent a problem. Their sentencing is inadequate to the crimes, and there are not enough courts to deal with this problem. This is a presentation that was made to us by the government of Mexico as they presented to us their recent counter-narcotics initiative. So there is no difference between our two countries. There is no denial in either country that the problems in Mexico are serious. But we still continue to believe that Mexico is in fact fully cooperating, and let me try to indicate how we came to that decision. First and foremost, and I think there has been no disagreement among any of us, President Zedillo is fully committed personally to fighting drugs and to a strong anti-drug alliance between the United States and Mexico. Senior officials in his administration, Administrator Constantine indicated Attorney General Madrazo as one, there are others as well, have a serious long-term commitment that is real, vital, and productive to cooperation with the United States and to dedication to deal with the drug problem within Mexico. In addition to that, last year in February, the United States and Mexico concluded a binational strategy, which represents the basis of an anti-drug alliance between the two countries of the United States. Following up on that alliance, over the course of the last year, the government of the United States and the government of Mexico have developed what we call performance measures of effectiveness, which were concluded this February after approximately a year's worth of negotiation. This commits both governments to looking at approximately 80 indicators of performance that both countries will collect data on, and then both countries will discuss how progress has been made along these indicators, where shortcomings have existed along these indicators, and how these performance indicators might show better in the year ahead. It is that embrace that countries who are both fully committed to cooperation would take. Countries that are in disagreement don't conclude this kind of agreement or don't conclude this kind of alliance. This is unprecedented in terms of cooperation between two countries, between the United States and any other country. In addition to that, the government of Mexico, as I indicated earlier, has just announced a major counter-narcotics initiative, approximately $400 to $500 million investment in law enforcement and infrastructure over the next several years. This is a announcement which was made public in February, but was actually heralded by both a budgetary decision which their Congress passed in December and an earlier announcement in August. This particular effort includes, first and foremost, a significant expansion of the anti-corruption activities of the government of Mexico. They will expand the number of personnel who will be vetted. They will fully screen officials who are currently performing counter-narcotics activities. They will establish oversight mechanisms to ensure the continuing reliability of those engaged in counter-drug activities. There is no misunderstanding on their part about how serious the problem is. And as Administrator Constantine said, this is an action that is going to require years of work, and they understand that and are not shying from that. In addition to that, they have also added state-of-the-art technology in airborne surveillance, high-speed patrol boats, helicopters, and mobile X-ray units that will also be added to enhance the capabilities of better paid, better equipped, better trained, and more professional law enforcement officials. In addition to that, with that counter-narcotics enhancement, Mexico now spends approximately 1.4% of its national budget on counter-narcotics activities. That is, by way of comparison, larger than the 1% which the United States spends on its budget. That is the heart of the argument in favor of full cooperation. But in order that we talk about the full range of performance, because it is not a perfect performance, I would also ask your indulgence to go over the two charts which I gave to you earlier. First, we have this chart, which is an attempt to take our International Narcotic Strategy Control Report data and extend it back to 1986 so that you have 13 years of data. The first two points that I would make are on opium.
Mr. Chairman, I ask unanimous consent that that chart be inserted in the record.
Without objection, so ordered.
Thank you, ma'am. The first points that I would make refer to opium and cannabis cultivation. As you can see, with respect to the 1998 column for opium, the amount of potentially harvestable opium has gone up from 1997 to 1998. I think it's important to look at this time series data over the entire range. We are disappointed, the Mexicans are disappointed, that the amount went up. It represents above the mean, but not far above the mean for the entire dime data series. Equally important to remember, because we're talking about cooperation and effort, the eradication, the effective eradication on the part of the Mexican government, you can see, has also gone up. In fact, if you look at the time series data, that effective eradication, and that's not information that we have taken from the Mexican government, that is information which we have obtained by our own intelligence collection. Potentially harvestable crop has had effective eradication, which was 9,500 hectares this year. In that context, it is important to remember that overall field size, as we have determined, has generally gone down. The amount of camouflage and intercropping has generally gone up. In addition, if you look at the cannabis production, you'll notice that that has generally come down over time. Eradication is up and down over that point in time, but the overall potential yield has come down, I think, significantly over that long-term time series. With respect to seizures, opium and heroin both are not very favorable this year. The opium gum is down, the heroin is up, but not significantly. This is an area that we in the Mexican government, I think, need to do better on. Cocaine, as you correctly indicated, has come down significantly from last year. I think it's important to divide the time series into two large chunks of time. If you'll go back to the time period from approximately 89 to 93, you will see quite large seizures. Those are the result of a cooperative effort between DEA and the government of Mexico called the Northern Border Response Force, where we and the Mexicans, using helicopters that we generally provided, were able to interdict serious small plane incursions into northern Mexico. The traffickers changed their pattern of activity as a result of that, and we and the Mexicans have not adapted effectively to be able to seize the same levels. But if you look at the next five-year time period, you will see, except for the spike in 1997, that we're talking about roughly the same overall performance level of cocaine seizures. With respect to cannabis, I think you can see that over the long-term trend, we're basically talking about a rising amount of cannabis seizures. With respect to methamphetamines, which the administrator has described as an exceedingly serious problem for the United States, while we had a modest increase in the amount of methamphetamine seized this year, over the longer-term time series, it's nothing to speak of. What has happened that is new and different, and I believe important, is that Mexico has now also criminalized precursor chemicals. And for the 2 years of data that we have since they have undertaken this, you will see that overall there is a rise in the amount of precursor chemicals that have been seized. With respect to labs, they are down over the most recent years, and that is a cause for concern and something we should look at. With respect to arrests of nationals and foreigners, it's a relatively constant picture over time, although there were some periods in which there were very high peak years. I'd like to go from that data to the second chart, which I handed out, which refers to extraditions. This is a very serious problem, a very serious issue, and one which I think it is important that we all understand. As Administrator Constant.
Without objection, that chart will be made a part of the record.
Thank you, ma'am, and thank you, sir. As Administrator Constantine has indicated, and as our government has indicated, this is a serious issue and one which we care about a great deal and talk with the Mexican government a great deal. It is important, I believe, as we look at this process, to consider that it is a two-part process. The process as a whole generally involves the Mexican courts at a low level first making a decision based on Mexican law that a Mexican national cannot be extradited. That decision by that lower court is then referred to the foreign ministry. The foreign ministry has an extraordinary power with respect to Mexican nationals to override that law and has done so in a number of occasions. What we have gathered here and what we're trying to depict and what I will now explain is, firstly, the number of extraditions that the government of Mexico, the executive branch, has authorized and the number of individuals that the Mexican court system have allowed to be extradited, and the number of deportations which the government of Mexico administratively have authorized to come to the United States. Firstly, with respect to those who were authorized for extradition, I apologize, we don't have data for 1995. We will try to update that. But if you look at that time series, you will see that the government of Mexico as a whole has generally increased the number of individuals who have been authorized, and there have been Mexican nationals who have been authorized for extradition, including, as Administrator Constantine said, one of the Amescua brothers. The Mexican courts have not been as cooperative, shall we say, or at least have been unwilling to extradite at the same levels that the government has been willing to authorize extraditions. And you see below, excuse me, a lower level of extraditions that were actually affected, individuals sent to the United States. And as has been correctly noted throughout, although there are four Mexican nationals who have been extradited over the past 4 years, none of those individuals are major drug traffickers. There is one minor drug trafficker, but no major drug trafficker of Mexican nationality has been authorized for extradition. There was a major drug trafficker, Garcia Abrego, who was a dual national. That's the indication in the 1996 column. Overall, there have been drug traffickers, but they have all been foreign citizens. It's equally important, I believe, to also look at the deportations, which, as you can see, these are not Mexican nationals, but they have arisen, over this time frame. In addition to that, it is also important to note that we have this year, for the first time, two successful prosecutions under Article 4 of the Mexican Constitution, in which an individual who was denied extradition to the United States was successfully prosecuted within the Mexican court system and brought to justice. So while we do not have what we believe to be an entirely adequate system of extradition, we are at least seeing cooperation with respect to the government in the prosecution of some individuals who have not been extradited. In addition to that, we have the first money laundering prosecution after the money laundering laws have been established. We have vetted units that are coming online. But that is not to say that this is a perfect record. And Administrator Constantine, I think, has made that case quite clearly. Particularly, we are concerned about the corruption that has been found in vetted units after they have been vetted. That said, those individuals have been moved to other assignments, perhaps not entirely adequate, but at least out of the picture of working with us in those vetted units. Moreover, much of the information that we have is derived essentially from Mexican government and law enforcement officials. We have two significant negative court decisions regarding extradition of criminals to the United States. Having said that, the Mexican government has indicated to us that those decisions will be appealed. And we have, as I indicated earlier, the rising opium poppy cultivation, which expanded despite an increased effort. These are issues and areas of concern. But let me also come back for a moment and talk very briefly about the overall record in terms of trying to deal on the part of the Mexican government with the senior levels of management of the various cartels which exist in Mexico. First, the Juarez or Correa Fuentes organization, the chief of security, Noe Brito, was rearrested this year. General Jesus Gutierrez Rebollo received 14 additional years, making his term of sentence 30 years for the corruption that he undertook on behalf of this cartel. Carlos Tapia, the reported founder of the cartel, has received 27 years in prison for the result of his actions. 65 members of the cartel have been indicted, although not yet arrested, and 111 cartel properties have been seized in 1998. With respect to the Tijuana cartel or the Arellano Felix organization, General Alfredo Navarro Lara received 20 years for bribery on behalf of the cartel. The two Arellano Felix brothers have been formally indicted. Key security and money launderers have been indicted. The key lieutenant, Paez Martinez, has been approved for extradition. In the Sinaloa cartel or the Miguel Caro Quintero cartel, we have two key lieutenants arrested, R.C. Jacopo and Jose Soto Soto. We have two outstanding provisional arrest warrants for Miguel and Rafael Caro Quintero, and the youngest brother, Jose, remains in prison under arrest. I think that in addition to that, we have the Colima or the Amezcua Contreras cartel. The two brothers are arrested and remain in prison despite the dismissal by the Mexican courts of the Mexican charges, basically on the charges that we have brought against those individuals. 17 members have been indicted. The Adan Amezcua Contreras, another brother, has also been indicted for firearms violations. In addition to that, a member of the Colombian Cali cartel, who is a lawyer operating in Mexico, William Moran, has also been arrested, and we have a, and that was done at our request. This is a mixed record, but we believe that in toto, with respect to the issue of fully cooperating, that we have a Mexican government that is committed to cooperation with the United States. We have indications by that government of serious intent to do serious business, and indications that they have done that serious business. They are waging independently and in cooperation with us a serious counter-narcotics effort. It will require time, it will require effort, it will require commitment, and it will require cooperation by the United States with that government to develop the mutual trust that we need to make over the time ahead. That concludes my presentation. Thank you very much for this opportunity to testify, and I'd be happy to answer any questions that you might have.
I have questions for both of our witnesses, but I am going to yield for just a moment to the chairman of the International Relations Committee, who has joined us, who has a statement he would like to make. He's left a meeting to come here, and without objection, if I may, I'd like to recognize him at this time.
Thank you, Chairman Mike, and I regret that I was delayed in coming up, and I'm going to have to return. We're conducting a markup on several foreign policy measures down in my committee. And I want to thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your leadership in holding this important hearing on the President's, what I consider, ill-advised full certification of Mexico and our common fight against illicit drugs. And I thank you for bringing two top-notch panelists before us, Mr. Beers from our Department of State and Tom Constantine, our DEA director, both of whom have been highly instrumental in trying to formulate a more effective drug policy for our nation. And I appreciate your longtime efforts, Chairman Micah, both in helping draft the original certification statute and working with me on so many others here in the Congress in trying to keep illicit drugs in the forefront of our foreign policy and our national security agenda. Several presidents in the past have said drug trafficking is a national security problem, and too often we forget that issue. Your understanding about how the annual drug certification came about is important for those who wonder how we got here in today's measuring Mexico's performance. And we in the Congress for far too long have heard many good words and pledges about fighting drugs together, but very often little concrete action was ever forthcoming from the major producer or source nations who often promised to help us. These very same producers or transit nations would also, of course, at the same time like the benefits of our taxpayers' largesse in the way of economic assistance, in way of aid, trade, and multilateral loan guarantees, and other benefits that we often consider as part of our foreign policy. Congress in 1986, I think, wisely combined the need for full cooperation with our efforts against drugs with the major producer or transit nation's right to access to some of American taxpayers' largesse. The American people have overwhelmingly supported certification since that time. And I also noted with some astonishment just last April in a Wall Street Journal poll that 65% of the people in Latin America agreed with the American public in that approach. They also favored U.S.-imposed sanctions on countries not doing enough to combat drug production and trafficking. I remember at a recent, not too long ago, a conference in Atlanta arranged by former President Carter, in which we were debating the drug certification process, and there was some question raised as to whether or not that was beneficial to our policy. And I happened to sit next to the former president of Bolivia, who leaned over to me and he said, you know, if it wasn't for the drug certification problem, despite all the protests to the contrary, we wouldn't have passed very significant legislation in our parliament on drugs, on asset seizures and money laundering. He said it's been a strong motivation, and I certainly agree with that. The American people have been joined in support of certification by important groups such as the National Conference of Mayors and the National Narcotics Officers Association Coalition and other police officials who daily face the brutal cost and the deadly consequences of illicit drugs from abroad on the streets and the communities of our nation. Simple, straightforward, and most importantly, always seeking our assurances from these producers and transit nations like Mexico that besides words, the president would be able to say to the Congress, we're getting full cooperation in our drug war. No challenge, I don't think, is more important than this vital fight against illicit drugs, especially in our own hemisphere. Mexico is a neighbor to the south, an important neighbor, and the gateway, regrettably, for nearly 60% of the illicit drugs entering our nation. And as good neighbors alone, never mind the multilateral loan guarantees they may receive from us, I think we're entitled to full cooperation, and they to ours as well. We are doing our share here at home with billions spent on demand reduction and treatment, as well as reducing supplies. We've also provided assistance to the Mexican authorities in many areas to help them do a better job in fighting drugs. I led the way when Mexico wanted to get its military more involved in fighting drugs, in helping obtain 72 U.S. Army Huey helicopters from Mexico. And we're pleased, incidentally, Mr. Beers, we thank you for your help in the recent initiative to provide Hueys for Colombia, the Colombian narcotics police force. It's been pleading for them for many months now, and we welcome the opportunity that we're providing to them to help them fight the war. The fully cooperating, and that's in quotes, certification decision of Mexico's dismal record for 98 cannot and ought not stand unchallenged. The administration itself is now in the business of giving us mere words, not any evidence of any concrete deeds in action. We understand a resolution of disapproval has already been introduced. And wisely, I note, with a national interest waiver, so we give Mexico the failing grade of F they deserve for performance in the war on drugs without any adverse economic consequences. I look forward to working closely with Chairman Mica in this area of disapproval in the days and weeks ahead. We need to sit down and we need to discuss our concerns with the Mexican government. They are not apparently hearing what they need to hear from the administration. It was very nice of them to say they've gotten some new equipment, new radar instruments that are going to help in spending $400 million in that direction. But that's not the end all, and that's not the most effective thing they should be doing. And I welcome the statement this week of the minority leader, Mr. Gebhardt, that he felt compelled to disagree with the President's certification in Mexico. This isn't partisan politics. It's about our young people. It's about our communities. It's about our national security. As I said yesterday at our own International Relations Committee hearing, the high-level working groups that our nation and the Mexican government now routinely convene on cooperating in fighting drugs, and we're pleased they're doing that, are avoiding the reality and the poor record that's obvious to all of us. Perhaps the high altitudes of those working groups affected the judgment of the administration officials who recommended to the president, and they made a strong recommendation to the president. The president apparently relied on it. The totally unjustified decision to certify Mexico as fully cooperating in our common war on drugs. And I'll try to be brief in closing. The facts are very different in Mexico. Drug seizures are down. No major kingpins have been extradited to our nation. The administration admitted as much yesterday, even with all the charts and graphs, in trying to paint the best picture. In addition, the Mexican government is yet to permit our courageous, dedicated DEA agents that Mr. Constantine has been seeking to carry sidearms with full diplomatic immunity in a dangerous drug war, permission that virtually every other cooperating government has provided. The head of the DEA, our lead drug fighting agency, and I'm pleased he's here, Mr. Constantine, and we call him a cop's cop, has called the corruption in Mexico the worst criminal threat to our nation that he's ever seen in nearly 40 years of law enforcement. I ask unanimous consent that the hearing record, Mr. Chairman, include a column from today's Washington Post by Bob Novak. Mr. Novak has examined the DEA administrator's outstanding law enforcement record and his clear and unambiguous analysis of the situation in Mexico today, and he's concluded, as many have here in the Congress on both sides of the aisle, that the administration is also corrupting the certification process with this kind of full passing grade that it's provided to Mexico.
Without objection, that'll be made a
Thank
part
you,
of the
Mr.
record.
Mr. Chairman, and in closing, let me say, much more needs to be done. Congress is going to have to help lead the way, and I look forward to today's testimony, and I'll have an opportunity to examine it on the conclusion. I regret I'm going to have to return to my International Relations Committee. But I want to thank you for this opportunity to appear and for giving me the opportunity to add my words to your important hearing. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank Chairman Gilman and look forward to cooperation of our two committees, subcommittees, in this effort.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
If I may, Mrs. Mink has a unanimous consent request.
Congressman Dennis Kucinich asks unanimous consent to have his opening statement
Without
inserted.
Without objection, his statement will be made part of the record. If I may, I'd like to proceed with questions. We can get right into it, and members have a comment or opening statement. We'd be glad to insert them in the record. First of all, Administrator Constantine, Congress passed, the House of Representatives did several years ago, requests of Mexico, I think six very specific requests, that we wanted to see some cooperation. I think it's almost exactly 2 years ago in March. And can you tell me, as I go over these, whether anything has been done or not, to your knowledge? First of all, a maritime agreement.
That's something that you probably have to ask the Coast Guard or the State Department.
But to your knowledge, is there any progress in a maritime agreement?
I couldn't say one way or the other, Congressman. All right. I'm not familiar with the progress on that.
Mr. Beers?
We have begun over the course of the last year a
Has a maritime agreement been signed between Mexico and
No,
the
sir. United. We're in process.
Thank you, Mr. Constantine. We asked for protection of DEA agents. Another one. Has that been...
Well, I've always publicly tried to avoid the levels of protection so that I don't increase the threat to any of the agents, but the issues involving
the
safety of our agents have not been resolved as of yet.
Have we extradited one major drug trafficker? That was the third. You said no, Mr. Beers?
Garcia Abrego, sir.
One, Mr. Constantine, is one major Mexican
He's a dual national, sir. Excuse me, I don't mean to mislead.
All right.
Not to my knowledge, Congressman.
Thank you. We had also requested not only enactment of money laundering and corruption laws, which were done at that time of our request. I think these were already in place, but we asked for cooperation on money laundering. Mr. Constantine, have they been cooperating?
It's my understanding the law has been passed. We have not had any major investigations.
Casablanca, what did they do with Casablanca?
Casablanca was a customs case, and I'm not familiar with all the details with it, but I'm aware
of the issue. Did they threaten to indict our officials?
That's the reports that I read, yes, sir.
Thank you. Radar in the South, has there been any progress on radar? Putting radar in the South was another thing that was specifically mentioned.
I'm not familiar with that or what
progress
has been made.
Mr. Beers, is there radar in the South?
No, sir, not to my knowledge.
Thank you. So in each of these areas, we have seen almost no progress. Mr. Constantine, are the figures that we have, are the seizures down on heroin? Are the seizures down on cocaine?
The seizures, as reported by the government of Mexico, on both heroin and cocaine are down, yes, sir.
Now, you gave me this chart that I held up on production. Is the production of heroin up or down?
That's the signature analysis program.
Production, and you're seizing this, and this is what you can identify in the United States seized and its source.
Yeah, let me give a little bit of context to that. There are three primary ways that we try to assess the source of heroin in the United States. One is the signature analysis program. Signature analysis program is, as you said, seizures usually at ports of entry. The drug is then sent to our special testing laboratory, and we get the results that way. The second is what we call a domestic monitoring program, where we actually go out and buy heroin in selected cities in the United States and send that in for analysis.
Are we seeing more Mexican-produced heroin or less?
Yes, sir. That figure,
more or less, sir?
More, sir.
Okay.
But to give you a sense,
methamphetamines, you said that they're explosive?
Well, there's been, in the United States, we moved in a 5 or 6 year period of time from a very low-level drug problem of the use and manufacture of methamphetamine to a substantial abuse problem within the United States, in a whole change in the manufacture and the distribution system from the low-level motorcycle gangs to major organized crime systems based out of Mexico.
Mr. Constantine, is there a single government of Mexico law enforcement agency which your DEA agency has complete trust and confidence in?
I would say, in working with the key people that I've worked with, Mr. Madrazo, Mr. Iberola, and Mr. Horan, I find them to be honest and trustworthy. The problem that they have and we have is that every major criminal investigation that we've conducted and that I know of, somewhere in the investigation involves a corrupt law enforcement official or systemic corruption. So it's we limit our sharing of information to a very select group of people that we think we can trust.
Mr. Constantine, am I correct that we've moved from corruption to a form of narco-terrorism? You cited the Baja Peninsula. I also understand the Yucatan Peninsula. Are these controlled by drug interests at this point? And are there other areas controlled by drug interests?
I wouldn't define either of those areas as narco-terrorism. What I would say in both the areas that you've defined is that the level of drug trafficking, the power of the organizations, and the corruption that's occurring within the systems makes it difficult, and obviously by virtue of the fact that none of them have been arrested, virtually impossible to apprehend.
The situation has been reported out of control in the Yucatan Peninsula particularly. with reports that the governor there is closely linked to drug traffickers, and because of his connections with the government may not even be subject to arrest. What's your take on that situation?
I believe you're talking about the former governor who leaves office. I think he was there was an election that was held. That's an investigation that was conducted, is being conducted by the governor of Mexico. I would not comment in a public forum about elected officials in an ongoing criminal investigation.
And we'll have an opportunity next Thursday. We're planning a closed briefing by you and others from the intelligence community on the situation. Just alert the members. Mrs. Mink and I had requested that, and we're pleased that you're complying with that. Mr. Constantine, based on your knowledge of the law, and the law is pretty simple. I helped draft it back in the 80s, a certification law. It says that a country must be certified as fully cooperating. Based on your knowledge of the law, and I don't want a political answer, I don't want a diplomatic answer. You are a chief law enforcement, you are the chief law enforcement officer we have to rely on in the in this entire illegal narcotics area. Would you recommend certification or decertification of Mexico?
Congressman,
as fully cooperating.
And this is not a diplomatic political answer, but it's the answer that I have articulated ever since I've been in Washington. I don't think it's the role of a law enforcement official to evaluate somebody for a public or political policy decision like certification. So all that I do is I provide the policymakers who make those decisions with what the picture looks like, how the criminal organizations operate, and how we respond to them. And I have very carefully avoided that.
Is the picture one of fully cooperating?
No.
Thank you. I'd like to yield now to the ranking member, Mrs. Mink.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The testimony that you have provided this morning, linking up the major organized crime families in Mexico with the distribution system within the United States, is very terrifying and places a dual responsibility in your agency to not only help us understand the source issues within Mexico and how they're coming into the United States and where the control and corruption and trafficking is within Mexico, but also how that distribution system impacts in our metropolitan areas and in our cities and communities all over the country. So I see this as a dual challenge to your agency, and you have very, very accurately described the dilemma of trying to interdict or arrest or apprehend these foreign connections that are within our cities. You indicated that many of them have been indicted, but have fled, and therefore the criminal justice system has not been able to bring them to trial and to so-called fulfill the justice responsibility, and that's very disappointing. I have a very strong interest in this field because I believe that the frustration of the American public is that they're not aware of the great efforts of your agency because we don't see the whole picture and the connection with the source and with this whole discussion about certification, which I believe is interconnected. Now, following on the chairman's question, which you felt disinclined to respond to because the decision is not yours, it's something that all factors have to be put together and then the president makes his decision. But if the Congress were to decertify Mexico, may I ask you the question, what would be the impact of that decertification on the work of your agency?
Be difficult to predict. It would be based in part, I suspect, on the reaction of the government of Mexico. I couldn't predict. Those places where we've looked at it historically, at least since I've been in the city, Columbia, I think, is the classic example. It resulted in increased cooperation and results and sharing of assets because of the reaction. That does not guarantee that there would not be a completely different reaction from the government of Mexico. That, I think, is a question that would be best asked to someone other than myself. I'm not clairvoyant. By the way, you're very perceptive for a new person who has read this, as you explained, to understand our problem. Our problem is exactly that organized crime situation, because we invest a tremendous effort and amount of money in seizing drugs and arresting key individuals. But where we wind up, Congresswoman, is we wind up with mid-level people who we can find as operatives in the United States, but their bosses hardly ever come here for fear of being arrested or indicted. So whereas when Attorney General Kennedy had this approach of going after the leadership as the ultimate goal and we were successful, we are frustrated by the fact that the people we know are directing these operations literally so far are immune from sanction generally. And so, yeah, you have a very good grasp of what our problem is.
Now, when you talk about having indicted some of these traffickers, you're not then talking about the top of the rung, but the middle level.
We have arrested the middle level. We've indicted them and arrested them when we can find them in the United States. We have indicted the key leaders and the top of the organizations based on the things that they do, the acts that they commit or part of a conspiracy within the United States. Those are the individuals who so far have been immune from sanction.
Now, is it possible for you to submit to the committee a list of these high-level traffickers indicted?
I could give them to you by name and by rote. I know them. We all know them. They're written on our minds indelibly.
Well, if the committee would indulge, may we have that in the record at right now? It's something that I'm very, very much interested in having in the record.
The two key people from the Ariano Felix organization that control the whole Tijuana Mexicali distribution system up into the West Coast have both been indicted. Ramon Ariano Felix is a top 10 fugitive in this country for the last 2 years. You have Rafael Carol Quintero. He is in prison in Mexico in a relationship to a murder of a DEA agent in the mid-1980s, but he's still wanted here for crimes. Miguel Carol Quintero, which Mr. Beers mentioned of the Sinaloa group. To give you a sense of our frustration, he's been indicted again and again, and when I mentioned his name as a potential target in Mexico City a little over 2.5 years ago, he called a radio station to accuse me of slandering his reputation and said that he had routinely driven through police roadblocks and military roadblocks and was never challenged despite my comments. He then, a year later, gave an interview with the Washington Post about the same issue. He is a leader of a major organization. We have Vicente Carrillo Fuentes, the brother of the famous Carrillo Fuentes organization, Eduardo Gonzalez Chiarte, Oscar Malarbe, Arturo Paez Martinez, which Mr. Beers mentioned has been arrested, but we're awaiting extradition, Jaime Gonzalez Castro, Jaime Ladino Avila, Jose Gerardo Alvarez, William Brian Martin, Miguel Angel Martinez Martinez. These are all key figures, including the two Amezcua brothers who were key, and I gave great credit to the government of Mexico for their arrest. Their extradition and return to the United States would be a major asset for us in these investigations. And there are a number of others, and I'll submit them on the record for you.
You spoke in your testimony about the personal danger that many of the DEA agents are constantly under. I'd like to ask you, what personal dangers are you under as the person leading this agency?
Well, I don't know. From time to time, obviously, there are people who would say it's dangerous, but I've been doing this for 39 years. Perhaps I'm fatalistic. and don't play the threats too low. I carry my own firearm and protect myself as I have for all of those years. I suspect the more I testify about these people, the more I explain who they are and the bigger danger they are to the United States, the greater danger perhaps I raise for myself. But I'm more concerned about the people who work for me and who, as I mentioned in my conclusion, who night and day are willing to protect us, and many of them get killed in the line of duty, and the seriousness of that and how serious we have to be to go after the leadership. I have two sons of mine who are in law enforcement. I probably worry about them more than I worry about myself.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Please now to recognize, for purpose of questions, the gentleman from Arkansas, Mr. Hutchinson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate both Mr. Constantine and Mr. Beers' testimony today. Let me follow up on the very important line of questions that's been asked, which relates to extradition. And that's probably the most critical weapon that we have in dealing with the foreign nationals who impact our drug importation in the United States to such a heavy degree. As has been pointed out, the government of Mexico has approved the extradition in a number of cases, but it has been blocked to this point by the judiciary. First of all, Mr. Constantine, what is the impression of the judiciary? There has been corruption in the mid-level law enforcement branch in Mexico. How does the judiciary, how does it handle the potential of corruption? Is bribery a problem in the area of the judiciary?
I'm not an expert, Congressman, on the judiciary or their corruption issue. There have been significant cases where certain traffickers have been released, and there have been serious allegations of corruption on the part of the judiciary and significant bribes that were supposedly paid for their release. But that's all secondhand information for me.
Mr. Beers, do you have a comment on that?
Yes, sir, I do. I would support what Administrator Constantine said. There have certainly been reports of bribes. The Mexican government has expressed concerns to us about this particular issue. Whether or not there was a specific bribe associated with a specific extradition case, I do not have hard evidence to that, but I think that there's general agreement that it's a problem. Mexican government has recognized this problem also, as I've said, and has created the National Judicial Council, which is trying to reform the court system, but it's a long way to go.
Well, it's I've traveled to some of the South American countries and listened to some of their leaders, and unless you can have an honest judiciary, you cannot maintain the integrity of any law enforcement system. And it's important that the government of Mexico take steps in that direction. Extradition is very, very important, and it's one thing for the government to approve. It's another thing for the judiciary to block it, where the laws are in place to accomplish that. Mr. Beers, you mentioned the letters from the governors that you put in the record, and I have respect for all those governors, but are they not addressing the stability issue in our relationships with Mexico? And is that not, that really does not bear on the issue of whether the government is fully cooperating in the drug war? Is that correct?
Sir, I think the letter discusses stability as well.
Well, that's my point. The letters do address the stability issue. And for that reason, to me, that goes to a national security waiver. To me, the issue in certification process is whether they are fully cooperating. It is a objective standard that can be measured. You have put attitude in there as an important part of it, but to me it's a more of an objective issue. And the if they are not meeting that objective standard, then we should say, well, we should grant them a national security waiver for the purpose of stability. And I think that might be the points that the governors are making. I know that in reference to Colombia, you know, they were denied certification, and they worked extraordinarily hard in order to be granted some assistance the next year, and they were granted a national security waiver. And was that not beneficial, the way that we handled this with Colombia, Mr. Beers?
I would agree with Administrator Constantine. I believe that the initial decertification of Mexico based on the corruption at the highest levels of the government of Colombia, in fact, was appropriately determined and I think beneficial in overall terms, in terms of that government's, in particular that police force of that government, taking extraordinary efforts on behalf of that country and the world. As with Administrator Constantine, I also believe that that is not necessarily a predictor of what a Mexican government reaction would be, and I can't tell you either what exactly Mexican government reaction would be.
Certainly, that would be the case, but you know, we should first follow the law very carefully and trust the wisdom of that law and respect that, and then I think that even though it might not be a predictor, it certainly, I think, worked very well in regard to Colombia, and I think that they're moving in the right direction because of the stand that we took and the compliance with the law. Let me ask a question again to Director Constantine. In justifying the certification of Mexico, the administration has touted the Mexican government's arrest of the Amezcua brothers.
Amezcua.
Known as the kingpins of methamphetamine. But it's my understanding that all the drug charges against those three have been dropped and they remain in prison pending the resolution of the U.S. extradition warrants. Was there a trial for these men?
I don't know what the judicial proceeding was, but it was found that they were not prosecutable in Mexico on the violations, whether there was a lack of evidence or it was how the evidence was gained. The charges were all dismissed.
Are they still in custody?
Yes, sir.
Pending the disposition?
Pending one of them, I think it's Jesus, is a pending extradition in the United States, but both Jesus and Luis have pending charges in San Diego.
Is there any evidence that these traffickers continue to operate from their jail cells?
Not to my knowledge, Congressman.
Is the prison system becoming more stable in terms of reducing the amount of corruption?
I'm not an expert on their penal system, and I just couldn't comment on it, to tell you the truth.
And finally, because I know we have a vote that's going on, is there any mandatory minimum sentences in Mexico for drug traffickers or possession of drug substances like we have in the United States that has had such a beneficial impact in our country?
I'd have to get back with you. I'm not aware of that myself.
Nor am I, sir.
So, I mean, the amount of time, I mean, you recited somebody got 20 years. Do we know what that means? Does that mean they get out in 1/6 of the time? Is there a mandatory period of time? Do they serve 20 years? What does that mean?
Sir, I'll have to get back to you. I don't have the precise answer on that. But I would acknowledge, as did the government of Mexico, that their sentencing system is inadequate with respect to the crimes. They have told us that, and they are looking to try to deal with that problem themselves.
I think we ought to look into that, because it's not just sentencing, but also how long they serve and what happens after that, and whether we should encourage, you know, the use of mandatory minimums, more control over the sentencing process, more direction in that regard. And I thank the chairman.
I thank the gentleman from Arkansas. I would ask our witnesses to remain if they can. What I'm going to do is recess the subcommittee for 15 minutes approximately. We'll try to reconvene at 12:15. I'll give you a quick break. We do have members that have additional questions, and we'll try to expedite those upon our return. With that, this subcommittee stands in recess. like to call the Subcommittee on Criminal Justice, Drug Policy, and Human Resources back to order. I'm pleased at this time to recognize a gentleman who had the pleasure of working with as a ranking member of civil service when I chaired that subcommittee, a gentleman who has very eloquently stated the narcotics problem as it affects not only the nation, but specifically the area that he represents, we've heard reference to today, Baltimore. Gentleman from Maryland, Mr. Cummings, you're recognized, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate your comments also. I must tell you, Mr. Constantine, your answer to a question a few moments ago really touched me when you talked about your life and your concern about the men and women who work for you. And I can only say that I'm sure everybody up here feels the same way. We really do care about the men and women who put their lives on the line every day to make our world a safer place. And I hope that you will express that to them on behalf of our committee, that we do appreciate what you do and what they do.
Thank you.
I must tell you that I have a lot of concerns about whether Mexico should have been certified, because as the chairman said, drugs affect my community probably as much as or more than any community or district in the United States. When I go home, I literally sleep in fear because I am surrounded. My block is surrounded by folks who seem to deal in drugs 24 hours a day. So this is a very personal thing for me. And in our community, and I wish everybody had cable TV so they could hear some of this testimony. A lot of people, I don't even think they comprehend. I'm talking about good people, good, hardworking people. The question that we get constantly is, well, what's the government doing about the drug problem? There are no boats or planes that the people in our neighborhood own, so how are these drugs getting in the country? And I wish they could hear and understand how massive and difficult these problems are. And when we talk about corruption, I think it's very difficult to penetrate it, but I think someone, I think it was Mr. Hutchinson or the chairman, said something that I agree with. I can't think of too many other methods to get deep into effective corruption fighting than certification, and that leads me to my first question to both of you. It seems as if the certification process, and I understand everything you've said about opinions, about governments, I understand and I respect that. And if I cross that line with my question, just let me know, because I certainly don't intend to. But I'm wondering, here we are, we sit, of course, as a Congress of the United States representing the people, and we have this problem which affects so many Americans. And I think we're always trying to figure out how we can be most effective. And I was just wondering, of both of you, the certification process is one thing. Can you think of any other ways we can kind of force governments or push them into greater cooperation? I'm not even getting into whether Mexico is cooperating fully. I have my own opinion on that, but I'm just wondering if you all can see any way, because when I think about the corruption process, when you have threats of death and you also and violence, and then you have money, big money being used, Those are two very significant forces. And so I was just wondering if you all had any opinions as to other things that either the Congress could do with regard to making the certification process even stronger or more effective, or is there something else that we can do?
I think probably Mr. Beers would be better off to talk about process, but let me explain to you a little bit about something that I think is important to know, and I did earlier. These organizations that we deal with are not invulnerable. I've seen this again and again. They can be broken down, they can be brought to justice, and you can change the situation. There's not an infinite number of them. In those countries who have experienced this before, the United States being one of them, Italy, Thailand, Colombia, a select group, and it doesn't have to be an army of them, of very honest, courageous people in law enforcement leadership positions with support, start to make the appropriate arrest of the key individuals, which sends a signal to the citizens that law enforcement can be trusted and that they can then provide information and witness information to honest, aggressive law enforcement officials. In some cases, those, and you can kind of picture this in your life, those honest law enforcement officials appreciate some type of pressure from an external source to help change the situation. Now, whether that's certification or decertification or what other processes are out of there, I don't know, Congressman. I think it's one, trying to support those people or individuals who are there in a cooperative, bilateral fashion for as long as you possibly can. And if at the end of all of that effort that's not effective, then I think, speaking as a citizen rather than a head of DEA, that we have to do something as a nation to ensure these people are brought to justice. I spent 8 years working for Governor Cuomo at the height of the crack problem, New York City, New York State. I can remember his speeches to this day, and everybody knows he's a great speaker, but this one I remember. He would say, they don't grow coca in the Bronx. They don't grow opium poppies in Brooklyn. These drugs are manufactured from someplace else and distributed from someplace else, and that we need assistance at that time from the federal government in dealing with these issues external to the United States. Now, what that process would look like, there's a lot of people with better experience that I have in this and may know of previous negotiations, but I think there comes a point in time where crime leaders or orders, leaders of these drug gangs who visit tremendous devastation to Baltimore or New York or to Newark or Boston or whatever the city or town might be, have to pay a price for what they've done, or else the law enforcement system has virtually broken down completely. But I think Mr. Beers might be better able than I to talk about certification and alternatives.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. I generally agree with what Tom said. I think, and we were talking about this over the break, that both of us would agree that there's no single silver bullet solution to this. But I think we also both agree that a system which will allow a government or governments to go after the leadership of trafficking organization represents one of the premier policy choices in terms of dismantling and disrupting the largest trafficking organizations, and that it doesn't have to be a large army that does it. A small unit can do it. But then that country has to have also, I think, a criminal justice system that can also take the product of the work of that unit and turn it into the completion of the process, which is to incarcerate those individuals and to take away their ill-gotten gains and give them back to the people who were hurt, or the law enforcement officials who are paid to protect them. I would add to what Tom said, and I don't think he would disagree with this, that in addition to that, and that's a national solution, we are absolutely dependent upon international cooperation. These criminals don't honor international boundaries. They move across them. We are sometimes thwarted in our ability to be able to respond effectively because we all still exist in a world as government officials in which borders do have meaning. And DEA and other organizations, not just in this country, are looking at those problems. We are not by any means there yet. The third thing I would say in that, and it's in support of the international cooperation, and I spoke about it with respect to Mexico, but it's also not unique, and that is in that form of international cooperation is the ability to sit down with one's counterpart, look at the problem, describe the problem accurately, look at the policy options for solutions, talk about what the objectives are, talk about what progress has been made, and then talk about where deficiencies were and where other things might be done better. We're starting that process with Mexico. We're a little further behind in the hemisphere, but that's also an effort that has come out of the Summit of Americas in the hemisphere. None of this is going to solve the problem overnight. Corruption, the corruption that Tom talked about, is very serious, and Italy's ability to deal with that took how many years, Tom?
10, 15 years.
So Mexico is at least indicating to us how much they recognize the problem and that they're committed to doing something about it. Now we have to allow them to get on with doing it and support them in doing it, and hopefully we'll have the same results, and hopefully in a shorter amount of time.
Just one other question. I was listening to you, Mr. Beers, talk about extradition, and I couldn't help but think about this case in Maryland that upset so many of us with Israel. The young man who allegedly committed murder in Montgomery County, which is not very far from here. And we were very upset about that. Well, when I thought about it, and I thought about the 5-judge panel that said in a 3-2 vote that the laws just would not allow them to grant the request of the United States, I said to myself, I said, well, those are the laws of that country, and I guess that's, we just have to live with them. Do you, in this situation, I mean, do you feel that when it comes to extradition, that there is some unfairness with regard to Mexico, I'm just curious. In other words, do you think that it's weighted against either one of you, against the United States?
Then I have to make this clear. The biggest problem for us is the key figures are never arrested. I mean, it never gets to an extradition question.
You don't even get to that point.
Because the key leaders of organizations are very seldom ever arrested. And the reason that they're not arrested is that they have either intimidated the witnesses or they've corrupted the public officials. Then once arrested, and if there are charges pending in the United States, as there are for many of them, then there would be a text of the extradition process. And there's one key individual who begins that process over the last several months, one of the Amezagua brothers. We'll see how that works out. But more important to me as a law enforcement official trying to deal with a major crime organization, when the leaders can continually, year after year after year, despite being their names being mentioned, identified every place in the world, can avoid even a simple arrest by virtue of the fact that they drive around congressmen in a convoy of 50 to 80 heavily armed people. A significant number of those heavily armed people are policemen, which means that a small group of honest law enforcement officials who tries to make an apprehension are placed in great jeopardy. We had in the Tijuana area this year where a courageous captain from the city police department tried to make an arrest of a major marijuana shipment and was shot and killed, and two of the people who were involved in the convoy for the load of marijuana who were involved in the killing of the captain were highway patrol or state police officers from that area. And that's kind of the sense of the difficulty of the apprehension.
Right, thank you.
Thank the gentleman from Maryland. Pleased to recognize the gentleman from Indiana, Mr. Souter.
Thank you very much. Good to see you both again, and I want to thank you both for your efforts. I have a number of questions. I know the corruption issue is very difficult. In fact, it's not even clear that in the United States we don't have more cabinet members and former cabinet members under investigation right now than Mexico, which is a troubling figure, not for narcotics, however. One of the questions that I have regards directly this question of the impact of decertification. I thought I'd ask Mr. Beers first, do you know of any country that we've actually decertified where there's been less cooperation after that? In other words, some haven't cooperated. If they were uncooperative, they continued to be uncooperative. They didn't all become more cooperative. But is there anybody who's become less cooperative after we've decertified?
I don't think it's fair to say that Burma has been any more cooperative since they've been decertified. Over the process, we had formerly a good cooperative relationship with previous governments in Burma, but since they've been decertified, they've shown no indication of a greater willingness to cooperate.
Any other country other than Burma? Because we decertify anywhere from 3 to 6 in given cycles.
I would also add that Nigeria has not shown any further cooperation during the period in which they
were they cooperating prior to that?
Excuse me?
Was Nigeria cooperating prior to that?
I'm sorry, I just don't have the information about that.
Because it doesn't always have a positive benefit, but in trying to anticipate whether it has a negative benefit as well, or a negative result. Mr. Constantine, I know from having talked with some of your agents in Southeast Asia that they too are concerned that Burma, which was human rights decertification, not narcotics cooperation decertification. Is that, do you know any other case other than, I guess it's Myanmar rather than Burma, besides that country where we've actually gone backwards if we decertified? In other words, what is the risk here based on past experience that decertifying Mexico would have a negative?
The only country that I think has had a direct impact on drug trafficking within the United States and was decertified was Colombia. The reaction in Colombia as a result of the decertification was positive. And in my sense of talking with people in law enforcement and other aspects of the community, they saw the pressure from the United States as supportive when they were in a difficult situation. But that's the only, I take, first of all, the nexus of a country that impacts us greatly. And I've only been here 5 years, and that's the one that stands out significantly.
Didn't, Mr. Constantine, didn't decertification not long ago result in one of your brave DEA agents, in fact, being released as part of the pressures of this process? I didn't say the company or anywhere, but in fact, there was a very practical impact on your agents.
Well, there was a lot of people who played a major role in that. I think his name is Inderfirth, or from the State Department, was fantastic, as well as the ambassador in fighting for us. Congressman Gilman was special in that he very early took a very public stand and was very, very supportive of us. And I think combining that, the comments that I heard that it would be difficult to say that that they're fully cooperative on a certification process. If a DEA employee, a national who was doing a drug investigation, was incarcerated for their efforts, and that's kind of my memory of how it all played out, and thank God from everybody's efforts, it was successful, and he's been released and is in the United States.
Mr. Souter, if I could intervene for just a moment. I'm asked to chair another committee hearing right now. I have additional questions for both of the gentlemen. I'll ask them in writing, and also we'll direct some questions to Mr. Constantine next week in a closed session. I'm going to turn the chair over to you, and I'll try to return as quickly as possible. And if you would introduce our second panel when you conclude and recognize anyone from either side, I appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Beers, one of the things as we go through the decertification debate that I'm sorry, I missed both your testimony. I'm not sure whether you gave this verbally, but in the written document, there's a lot of things that trouble me because we were just spent 3 days in the country, don't they? In other words, it doesn't end all trade.
That's correct, sir.
And we continued to ship them anti-narcotics things to the Colombian National Police, in other words, vetted units and so on. It isn't like it suddenly stops.
Counter-narcotics assistance and humanitarian aid are not cut off by a decertification.
And yes, it doesn't, sir, end all trade?
No, sir, it does not. Although there is a provision which could be implemented, which could have some trade impact. It's a separate provision by another law.
And while many in Congress who are not necessarily big boosters of NAFTA might like that, that's not likely to be a result. This isn't a straight NAFTA question of if all of a sudden Mexico were decertified that NAFTA's over.
That's correct,
it,
sir.
It would be optional whether you did additional.
That's correct, sir. It's a separate decision.
And why, I mean, one of the things that bothers me, because I'm listening to the foreign minister, the attorney general, interior minister, as well as the president, seem to be committed. We've met with members of Congress and the Senate. But in your document here, you have a whole series of things. For example, there's a lot of laws that they submitted to Congress, but none have become final. The attorney general, I know, told us that part of the process, he's trying to follow the law, but now it takes a number of years to pursue the extraditions. But in your document, you also point out that they have this problem with the lifetime imprisonment clause, so it's not clear how extradition's going to actually work. We in our House, decertification in the past have had the maritime agreement, but they told us that we've never actually made an official request to them to sign the maritime agreement. In here, you say in 1998, they uncovered evidence of corruption in special vetted units that were specially created to avoid corruption, which we didn't even have in Colombia. This is a new variable. Why wouldn't we, at least in an interim basis, not restricting the trade portions necessarily, say, we appreciate that in February this year you have some more initiatives, we appreciate that you started some initiatives last year, but some minimum criteria here, like we go a year without your special vetted units being compromised. There was one line in here that says, to fight against corruption, a new national registry of public security personnel was used to match active duty police against those persons who had judicial proceedings pending against them. Boy, that's a pretty basic thing that should have been being checked about, 30 years ago. Why wouldn't we have not saying, implying that they don't have their motives correct, but use this as a leverage, like we did in Colombia and like the administration did in Colombia, to say we want to see specific progress in your courts, specific progress in your legislature that you're actually moving things, that we're seeing specific progress on the actual extraditions as opposed to you're starting the process.
Sir, we do that, and we have made some progress, and we believe that this year's certification decision is based on some of that progress made. And we also believe that we have also set up mechanisms that will allow that process to increase further over time. I spoke briefly at the beginning about these performance measures of effectiveness. One of the purposes of this particular process is for both countries to develop an awareness of what's going on in each country, to talk about the objectives, to talk about the milestones to achieve those objectives, and then come back after a time period. We'll come back at this in September and see what progress has been made and talk about a constructive criticism or cooperation which can improve that even further. So I take your point to heart, sir, and we are trying to do that, and I do believe that's why we've made this decision this year in order to fully certify them.
I believe, I heard the presentation of that document, and I do believe that not only Mexico but other countries are recognizing they have a domestic problem as well as an international, just like we have to do more on demand reduction. At the same time, we clearly heard a week ago last Saturday, from the foreign minister this frustration that they aren't being given specifically the things on the decertification. And my other point regarding your comments is that a lot of what are in that document are process. In other words, if you introduce a bill rather than standards that The bill has been done. And because I agree with you, one sign of goodwill is that a process starts. Another sign is actual results. I also want to take, I asked the chairman briefly whether this is in order. Yes, it is. I'm the chairman right now. And since I raised Columbia, I actually have a question regarding Columbia. You and I have talked about Blackhawks till we're both blue in the face, and Huey helicopters till we're blue in the face, and we're happy that we actually have six Blackhawks going to the Columbia National Police. We're, I think we're starting to see the progress on the Huey upgrades. When we met with people from your department and elsewhere in Columbia, I was concerned because I raised this question of the guns on the Blackhawks and making sure that they had the best, the Gal-19s rather than the M60s, and would like to continue to point out that when we have spent this amount of money in the Blackhawks, and I heard the explanations that, yes, you're under cost pressure, yes, there's ammunition questions, but the practical matter is that my understanding is that the M134s are from 1964 and they're having trouble getting spare parts, whereas the new guns are 1992. We have been told in Columbia that, for example, a Black Hawk helicopter that the military was using that had a M60 on one side and a Gal-19 on the other, all the battlefield damage has been on the M60 side because, in fact, even the narco-terrorists are figuring out which side they don't want to go to. There is a substantive difference in the two types of guns. And when we've invested this amount of money in the Black Hawks, I would argue that strongly and would like to hear any convincing evidence to the contrary that the amount of money that we're talking in the differential between these guns once we're this far along is not worth the argument that we're having. Let's get them down there, let's get them armed the best way, because long term, and the relationship to Mexico is, unless we can get control of the problems in Colombia, Mexico is going to continue to be a conduit. The United States is under direct pressure, and in my opinion, there's no more critical area of the world right now. Peru and Bolivia have made progress. Mexico and the Colombian government are trying to make some inroads, but we have a war going on down there. We can talk about being a cancer in the United States, but there's an actual war. And if we don't arm them in the absolute best ways, the pressure is they're going to come to us, like the people in Kosovo, the people in Bosnia, the people all over the world, and say, hey, America, how are you going to help? Because we have oil on the one side in Venezuela, we have drugs pouring in from Colombia, we have the canal on the other side. This is clearly a compelling national interest, and I don't understand the constant pressure you are with your funds not to impact Peru here and Bolivia here and Mexico here and how we're going to keep the Caribbean front up. But I would argue that this is potentially penny-wise and pound-foolish if we don't get them the best guns on the Blackhawks. Do you have any comments you'd like to make?
I would, sir. I agree with you that what we want to do is to give them the best weapons systems in association with the mission that they are asked to undertake. We have looked at this issue. We have favored the Mark 44. They have initially favored the Mark 44. They're looking at the issue again. It's not firmly and finally decided. I spoke to General Serrano the day before yesterday on this very issue, and we've agreed to continue this subject under discussion. But if I may make a simple point, and there's a lot more we could talk about, the simplest point from which we started, sir, was that with respect to the use of these two systems within the U.S. military, our special operations units use the Mark 44 on their Black Hawk helicopters, and our Army regular forces use the Gal-19 on their helicopter. We've asked, we've talked, we've tried to understand why one unit, a highly specialized elite set of units, have chosen to use the Mark 44. And we've asked why the Army has chosen to use the Gal-19. The Mark 44 rate of fire is higher, almost twice as high as the rate of fire of the Gal-19. The Gal-19 shoots further. The Gal-19 round is heavier. Those are both indications that would seem to favor it. They also mean that on a vessel, on a platform, you cannot take as much ammunition of the heavier variety as you can of the lighter variety. So what if you're talking about sustained firepower, I'm told by our military that that's an argument in favor of the Mark 44. We haven't settled this finally. We will continue to discuss this, and I'd be happy to give you a final report when we come to a final solution on this, sir.
Yeah, I'd like to continue to work with you because General Serrano continues to request that the Colombian Air Force have that. And when we particularly go up to the higher elevations where the heroin is, as we make actual progress, it's going to the firing and the counter firepower is going to get greater, not less. And I'm confident that General Wilhelm is getting a handle on both the defense side and the Colombian National Police, and they both need to be there. I'm hopeful that we can make progress, but at the same time, I want to make sure it's not a budgetary-driven question, that it's in fact a substantive, what is the best way to win this war, because the price of us marginally making decisions or being slightly behind all the time, we don't want another Vietnam where we're always behind.
You notice, sir, I did not argue the budget issue. I can make that argument, but I'm starting from where you're starting, sir. What's the mission? What's the requirement?
And also not only what the current is that, I mean, we keep hearing about the potentiality, and we know it's coming, of Stinger missiles and much more firepower in the hands of the FARC than we've seen, because if we start to make inroads, it will become greater, not less, and we need to prepare for the next step, not just where we currently are. Mr. Cummings had some additional questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Beers, when you were answering a question of the chairman, I guess over an hour ago now, he had asked you about a maritime agreement, and you gave your answer and said there was no maritime agreement, but it appeared that you wanted to say something else, and I want to give you that opportunity, whatever it may be, so that the record is clear.
Thank you very much, sir. What I was intending to say is that we began last summer to negotiate a multilateral maritime agreement with Caribbean states, of which Mexico is one. Mexico is a full participant in these maritime negotiations, and our negotiator prognosticates that he expects to resolve this maritime agreement over the course of the next year. That's where we are today. We'll continue to work on it, and we're happy to report to Congress any progress.
How important is that agreement?
Sir, the agreement allows, in its most general sense, navies and coast guards around the world or in any water to fully cooperate across international boundaries. That's the heart of it, which is if we see a problem and we are in pursuit and we are in international waters, we have a mechanism whereby we can communicate with a coastal state into whose waters those vessels may be proceeding. And they will then activate their own law enforcement officials in order to respond to that. Or if they are unable, then there's a provision in which the Coast Guard, the international state, could pursue that vessel into territorial waters. Always with the approval of the host nation, but a much easier process than otherwise, one which we have found works very well with the government of Colombia, where in almost every case, the government of Colombia, as a result of the cooperation mechanisms that have been set up, actually make the arrests. They come out, they pursue, they arrest.
Our agents, are they receiving adequate protection when they are in Mexico?
What I've commented before, and there is a closed session next week, I try to avoid talking about all of the security issues for agents in open sessions. However, there have been a lot of dialogue going back and forth, and both the diplomatic and physical security of our agents has not been resolved, and I believe it's insufficient for the task that we're giving to them presently.
The overall, would you all say we have less cooperation than, say, a year or so ago, or more, or about the same?
Well, as I mentioned before, I try to stay out of the cooperation issue because I think as a law enforcement official, that's a far afield. The one thing I will say
is
that traffickers are much more powerful than they were 5 years ago, and they've grown more powerful every year, and they have more wealth at their disposal to corrupt law enforcement officials and to use violence. And that's the experience that I see as a law enforcement official.
Now, still want to stay on this side of the line, because I'm not trying to get you over across this line that you don't want to cross. But have you come to some conclusions as to why what you just said has happened?
Well, the conclusions I draw is the people that I meet with, that I have respect for, the Attorney General of Mexico and his staff, want to do the right thing. The machinery under them has been so badly infected by both corruption and intimidation, it is difficult for them to achieve the things that they want to and we want them to achieve. And I think that is the present situation as I see it in Mexico today.
When you have an opportunity to interact, I guess you do, with just the Mexican people day to day, do you get the impression that they want to, and I know this may be a difficult question, but do you get the impression that they want to rid Mexico of this whole drug situation?
I'm not an expert on the culture of Mexico. The one thing I will notice is that the reaction to crimes of violence, police misconduct, crimes by policemen, and police corruption has received a great deal of attention in a way of public demonstrations, public outcry, concern over the citizens of Mexico, over the quality of law enforcement services that they have within the country. That I pick up from newspapers and translations.
When the general was arrested and convicted, there was some restructuring, am I right?
Yes, sir.
Do you think it's better now? And I know we've taken this one person out, removed him, but then when you restructure it, I guess the restructuring could be better or it could be worse. Have you come to any conclusions on that?
That's about the third or fourth restructuring that I've seen since I've been head of DEA. A lot of the responsibility in Mexico was taken away from civilian law enforcement because of the problems and given to the military. We're hopeful that these new vetted units, in other words, we work with the government of Mexico, we spend our money to make sure that these people have, as best as we can see, a very clean background and are not compromised. We bring them to a training facility in Northern Virginia. The Justice Department, the DEA, and the FBI train them and return them so that we can have a unit that we can share very critical information with. That received a major setback this year, I have to be honest with you, in which senior-level people within those units, by all indications and everything I could see, had been seriously compromised by the traffickers. So we can't give up. We're going back and trying to rebuild a new and better system. But that was a sense of major frustration to us this summer.
I would imagine that when you have a situation like the one you just described, or you have someone who has been working honestly and courageously, and the next thing you know, harm is done to them. I imagine that must be, those kind of events must really set back any kind of legitimate operation quite a bit. Was that a fair conclusion?
No, that's a fair conclusion. There's a number of police officials and prosecutors in Mexico who have been assassinated by all that we can see as a result of a contract assassination by the major drug organizations. And until those leaders are brought to the bar of justice and held responsible for that, I can just tell you, as a policeman in the United States, if I looked around and I saw my leadership core being regularly assassinated and bodies found in the fields, I would wonder how far will I go before I place myself or my family in the same jeopardy. And that's in my comments, that's the very purpose of this violence. It's what the mafia did in the United States. They never killed police officers, but they killed witnesses, and for a long time they had a code of silence until Attorney General Kennedy, I think, as I've said, turned that around. But that violence is not always random. That has a purpose, and the purpose is so that nobody's willing to testify, that policemen, if they don't take a bribe and they want to be honest, then are assassinated. I mean, there's at one time the mayor of the police chief of Tijuana back in 95 or 96 set out on a major strategy to go after the Ariano Felix organization in Tijuana. He was, by all of the reports, approached by the trafficking organizations and offered substantial sums of money to stop doing that. He refused to do that. He was told he only get one chance, and what happened to him next, he was led to a phony complaint and assassinated. When that happens to a police chief, that has a serious damaging effect to other people at other levels of the organization. There's no doubt about it.
I was just curious, as you were talking, I just two more questions. As you were talking, I couldn't help but think about in Baltimore, the police funerals that I've gone to, and think about all of the, I mean, we see it all over the country. People come, police officers come from everywhere, and it's just such a, I mean, it's taken very seriously. I mean, citizens take it very seriously. I guess it's because it is truly a thin blue line, a very thin blue line. And I'm just wondering, do when deaths to police officers come in Mexico, do you see the same kind of reaction? Do you know?
I'm not familiar with their system. I've been, as you said, to far too many. Since I've had these two jobs, as superintendent of state police in New York and head of DEA, I've had 25 people killed in the line of duty and have gone to 25 funerals and met with 25 families. And I think I've had... My roommate in state police school was shot and killed. I was a lieutenant in charge of recruit training at the state police. I had one class of 120 kids. Three of them were shot and killed within 8 years. All of those things have had an impact on me. And that's why I take this so seriously. I mean, that's why I find the Ariano Felix brothers, Vicente Carrillo Fuentes, Juan Aspergo, I find these to be despicable, evil people who have to be brought to justice and have to be penalized for that activity if we're going to have any sense of fulfilling the sacrifice that's been made by these individuals involved.
Last question. When you have, I'm just wondering, when the Mexican, when you talk to higher-ups and folks in the Mexican government, I mean, they know you pretty much know the lay of the land and what the problems are. I mean, do they say to you, look, you know, you gotta help us get around all of this? I mean, we're in fear. We're fear for our families, for ourselves. United States, probably the most sophisticated law enforcement agencies in the world, you know, help us. I mean, do you get that, or is it already assumed that you're going to do that?
The individuals I mentioned that I'm involved with, yeah, you have those conversations, try to find help. I usually pay a big price every time I testify on this issue for months afterwards, and I don't think that the relationship chills and becomes cool for a while, and I take a responsibility for that, but that's part of the job. But, yeah, we talk about those things. I find them to be the individuals that I've dealt with really want to do the right thing. I mean, our frustrations are their frustrations. But eventually, I think somebody mentioned that somewhere down the line, I don't know when the year is, I don't know when the date is, and we talk about this for a lot of years, there's going to have to be past the process, and there's going to have to be an actual demonstration of the results, similar to that which we saw in the United States, similar to that which we saw in Italy, similar to that which we saw in Colombia. And then I think we'll be making major progress and improvements.
I want to just thank both of you for your testimony, and want to thank you for all that you're trying to do to make our streets safer and our lives better. I really appreciate it. I'm sure I speak for all of us.
Yes, also thank you for how long it's been here and taking the different questions. We've worked with both of you for a long period of time, and not only for the behalf of our citizens and in Fort Wayne, where we now have a DEA task force starting up in Fort Wayne, Indiana, but people all over our country, and also in the DEA and in the State Department employees, as we've been in Central and South America and around the world, those people are right on the front lines. They've been very helpful, very forthcoming, and really appreciate the commitment. We may have disagreements from time to time on how to do different things, how to balance all the financial things, but what we need to do is have a united American front and really appreciate the efforts of DEA around the world, as well as domestically and the State Department, not only in directly fighting narcotics, but in helping in crop eradication and in crop substitution, where we're actually making some progress in some countries. And if we continue to make that progress and get the pressure on the transit zone and then in Mexico and win the battle in Colombia, we'll at least have moved it all to methamphetamines or something else. But it's the matter of this constant pressure, and we thank you both for your leadership.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
If the second panel could come forward, this time I'd like to recognize from the General Accounting Office, Mr. Ben Nelson, the Director of International Relations, Foreign Trade, National Security, International Affairs Division. He is joined by his Assistant Director, Mr. Ron Kushner. And before you sit down, we need to swear in all of our witnesses. So would you raise your right hand? Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give us is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Let the record show that the witnesses answered in the affirmative. Mr. Nelson, would you commence with your remarks when you're ready?
Mr. Chairman and members of the subcommittee, I'm pleased to be here to discuss our work on the counter-narcotics efforts of the United States and Mexico. My prepared statement, which I will veer away from a little bit in the interest of time, will highlight the findings from our ongoing effort to update our June 1998 report on this matter. This was requested by former Chairman Hastert and Senator Grassley. My statement covers two broad issues: Mexico's efforts to address the drug threat and U.S. counter-narcotics assistance provided to Mexico. You just heard administration witnesses provide their perspective on the drug problem facing our two countries. You heard about the threat. Let me recount. Mexico is one of the largest centers for narcotics-related business in the world. Mexico is still the principal transit country for cocaine entering the United States. Mexico is either a producer, refiner, or transit point for cocaine, marijuana, methamphetamine, and heroin. It is also a major hub for the recycling of drug proceeds. Mexico's Juarez drug trafficking organization is as powerful and dangerous as Colombia's Medellin and Cali cartels used to be. Mexico's porous border and the daunting volume of legitimate cross-border traffic, some 86 million cars and 4 million trucks, provide near limitless opportunities for smuggling of illicit drugs and the proceeds of the sales of those drugs. You also heard discussion about the level of progress that has actually been made. You also were told by administration witnesses of the problem of corruption. Our own work indicates that drug traffickers spend approximately $6 billion a year to suborn various law enforcement and public officials. You've also heard today about the new initiatives that the Mexican government plans to undertake to better address the problem. What you have not heard was much discussion on U.S. assistance to Mexico. In light of the fact that many of the key factors, the progress, or lack thereof, have been well established, I would like to focus briefly on U.S. assistance, the usefulness of it, and the nature of it, the usefulness, and trends in the provision of assistance. Since 1997, the Departments of State and Defense have provided the government of Mexico with over $112 million worth of equipment, training, and aviation spare parts for counter-narcotics purposes. The major assistance included helicopters, aircraft, and two Knox-class frigates, which were purchased by the Mexican government through our foreign military sales program. Last year, I testified that some of the assistance provided to the Mexican military was of limited usefulness due to operational and logistical support problems. In the past year, the two frigates have become operational. Unfortunately, the situation with the helicopters has gotten worse. All 72 of the helicopters provided to the Mexican military have been grounded because of airworthiness concerns. In addition, the four C-26 aircraft provided have not been used for counter-narcotics operations. Mr. Chairman, this concludes my opening statement. I or Mr. Kushner will be happy to respond to any questions that you may have.
I want to ask an initial question. I'll go to Mr. Cummings and then come back. You just alluded to these helicopters.
Yes, sir.
I've visited Colombia actually four times now, and have been to their facilities where they're repairing these things. If they think they can get it off the ground, the helicopter goes up. They borrow parts from all sorts of things to get their helicopters flying. You have a statement here that says, in addition, four C-26 aircrafts are not being used for counter-narcotics operations. Right before that, you say all of their UAVs are grounded because of airworthiness concerns, which
right.
is an American problem as well, and trying to get that up. But
That's
what about these four C-26? Could they fly?
I think, yes. The problem with the C-26 is, and Mr. Kushner can add to my statement since he's been down to Mexico, but the problem is not a mechanical problem. It's the mission, whether those aircraft can be suited for a counter-narcotics mission in their current state.
Sir, they're not configured for surveillance-type operations. It would cost about $3 million per copy to reconfigure those so the Mexicans could use them for surveillance-type operations. They received four of them, as we testified. One of them is completely down. I understand that the nose gear is collapsed and it has not been repaired. And the three other ones, they are operational. They may fly them for transport purposes, but no counter-narcotics missions are being
flown. Have they requested funds for these, or have they done anything in their own government to try to get them ready? They're just letting them sit there? Why do we give them to them if they're just going to sit there?
That's a good question. It's negative to both your questions. As far as we know, the Mexicans have not specifically requested funds to fly the C-26s, nor have the U.S. government provided funds to maintain and get those things operational. It's another thing, you can fly those aircraft, but they also have to be maintained, and it's a kind of a complex aircraft, and you normally would have a contractor come in and do the maintenance of them. There is no contractor down there maintaining those aircraft.
Did they request these?
As far as I know, sir, no.
So we
have four aircraft down there, sir, that are just basically not being used for counter-narcotics purposes. As we reported last year, and we made a recommendation to the Department of Defense and the Department of State, that better planning and coordination is needed when you're considering the type of packages you're going to provide for counter narcotics purposes.
Were they ever even consulted about these?
I can't answer that, sir. I do not know whether the Mexicans were consulted about their need for a C-26 or not.
Bottom line is that it looked good for us to send the stuff down there like there was an narcotics effort going on, but they didn't request it. There's no money in their budget for it. There's no money in our budget to get them up to speed. They're sitting on the ground, and they're not being used for counter-narcotics. Is your general impression from, have you looked at Colombia as well as Mexico and other research? Do you think the Colombians would have these sitting on the ground?
I have not looked at Colombia personally, but Mr. Nelson knows a little bit more about that than I do.
Mr. Nelson, do you think the Colombians would have these sitting on the ground without a request in? I mean, do you know of any case where there's a Colombian helicopter sitting on the ground that can fly?
Well, sir, to your first question, I can't answer whether, you know, this would be the case in Colombia, but I do not know of any helicopters that are sitting on the ground in Colombia that are not being used.
And when we were just in Mexico, we were told that they were going for more go-fast boats. They were looking for different surveillance equipment, and they were putting certain things in their budget. Now, all this
Correct.
Happened 10 days before certification was due.
Correct.
But that they had, because they're concerned about being able to control these coasts, wouldn't these four C-26 help with that?
If they were fitted with the...
why wouldn't you... Would these, if these were fitted properly, help with those efforts?
Yes, I would agree.
I'll yield to Mr. Cummings and I'll follow up.
I only have a couple of questions. I understand these gentlemen have to get over to the Senate. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
All right. Let me ask you this. Why is the organized crime unit short of fully screened staff, and do you know what the holdup is?
I think it revolves around having personnel to do the final screening of them. Questions have come up over the last 6 or 7 months with the rescreening of some of the individuals within the organized crime unit who actually failed the rescreening process. There's questions about how they're going to proceed again. So it's been slowed down somewhat. About 50% of the OCU staff are not fully screened.
Okay, you also, in the report, it talks about how you think that that Mexico needs a sufficiently screened, better paid corps of judges to hear drug cases, and I take it that this is not an idea that is brand new. What's the holdup there?
That hasn't been really pursued by anyone, as far as we know, within the government of Mexico. The screening process at the government of Mexico is instituted down there. It's staffed, but it's a limited staff, and it's limited equipment availability, meaning polygraph-type machines. Mm-hmm. So and these people have to be trained on the use of those machines. So I'd say it's a resource constraint as well as just prioritizing the people within Mexico and the law enforcement community and the judicial community that you are going to screen. They elected to go with the law enforcement and the specialized units initially.
And so you said initially, and then what happened?
Well,
you got past the initially.
The intent, as far as we know, is to continue this screening process. Well, it was certainly within the Attorney General's office. Now, the specialized units make up just a small part of the Attorney General's office. I believe this total staffing within the Attorney General's office is upwards of 17,000 people. We've been told that their goal is certainly to screen all those individuals, and they will move on.
Mr. Nelson, did you have something to add?
Yes, sir. I believe you raise a very important issue there with respect to the judges and not having a cadre of professional judges. First of all, I think the screening process, some judges may not have to, or it doesn't cover judges. The issue with the judges is critical in that other law enforcement actions, their effectiveness is reduced if, in fact, you capture the drug traffickers and bring them before a judge who will not met out the proper sentence, or that the people, the traffickers, are basically not convicted. And the corruption in the judicial branch is a critical issue in Mexico.
So you said judges aren't screened?
No, the judges are not screened.
It would, you know, I you would think that with all the problems that they have had and all the corruption, that you might move to that level. What? How do you define screening?
Basically, it's a test to determine whether an individual is connected with a trafficking organization, or whether they have something in their past that would raise questions about their trustworthiness. And as Mr. Krishna said, it involves like a lie detector test and some other steps.
Psychological profiles, social and financial background checks, medical and physical history. So those are the types of areas that they cover during the screening process, as well as the polygraph.
So how are judges elected then? I mean, what do they? What do they have to go through the process like federal judges do here, for example?
I'm not too familiar with the process of selecting judges in Mexico, but I believe a good number of them are appointed.
Okay. I don't have anything else. Thank you all very much.
Mr. Sutton.
Yes.
I have a response from staff back there on your question regarding helicopters in Colombia. I guess there's a big problem with the Hueys. I am told
that's universal in our military too.
Right. Only a third of those in Colombia were fully operational last year.
What the reason I've moved to the C-26s is that even our military, our guard units, all have a problem right now getting them grounded.
Right.
Right. So some countries have continued to fly those, but against our own advice.
Yeah.
I have a couple additional questions. If just to review some of the summary of your testimony here. In your testimony, both written and much of what you gave, you said in 1998, no major Mexican drug trafficker was surrendered to the United States on drug charges. You said the heroin threat from Mexico appears to be increasing. The cultivation of opium in Mexico producing poppies increased by 3,000 hectares in 1998. You said that corruption remains widespread within the Mexican government institutions, including the criminal justice system. You said that a number of senior military and screened personnel were found to either be involved in or suspected of drug-related activities. You said that the helicopters weren't in the air, particularly the C-26s. The Mexican narcotics trafficking organizations facilitate the movement of between 50 and 60% of almost 300 metric tons of cocaine consumed in the United States. You said that drugs are still flowing across the border at the same rate approximately as 1997. You said there have been no significant increases in drug eradication and seizures. I think the statistics we were given, even by the Mexican government, said that cocaine and opium gum seizures declined, and their statistics they gave us in maritime had also declined, interdiction. You said that money laundering prosecutions and convictions have been minimal. You said that corruption remains a major impediment to Mexican counter-narcotics efforts. And you said that most drug trafficking leaders continue to operate with impunity. As far as results, have you seen any good results or any signs that they're fully cooperating from a results side?
Yeah, well, there were some results last year, and the witnesses here have pointed out the situation in Cancun, where the property of drug traffickers was confiscated, and of course there was there was another initiative. What was the second one?
Well, I think one of the major accomplishments that happened in Mexico this year, as was pointed out by Mr. Constantine this morning, was the arrest of Jesus and Luis Amezcua. And previously they arrested his brother Adan. That is considered, I think, certainly within the law enforcement community, a major accomplishment. The operation in Cancun was a major undertaking this past fall, where about $200 million worth of property has been seized, including four hotels, a number of restaurants, a number of yachts, and about 22 residences. So,
anybody arrested?
Pardon me, sir?
Anybody arrested, governor or political officials?
No, sir. As far as we know, there has been no major arrest made in the Cancun operation. That doesn't mean that there hasn't been any small operators arrested. I don't think there's been any major operative in Cancun or in the Yucatan that's been arrested.
The arrest could be viewed as a positive. It's been established here that the charges against both have been basically dropped, and it's only the U.S. request that is holding them in jail at this point.
I mean, it's a problem for those of us in Congress who represent districts where, in my district, there's been a shift of where the drugs are coming from. They're mostly coming from Mexico, and as we see, particularly heroin pouring into our country that's native to Mexico. It isn't even just a transit zone. And that, in effect, what you're telling us is that the heroin threat's increasing, the cocaine threat's increasing, they're not doing the helicopters, they're having problems screening their people, corruption's widespread in their courts, they've actually gone down, or at least not net had any increases in eradication and seizures. They're plowing across the border, they're threatening to sue us over a money laundering prosecution, that their drug leaders continue to operate in impunity, and the two good signs are that in Cancun, they started a process, although they haven't arrested anybody, and in the other place, they've started a process, but we don't know whether they're going to be prosecuted, and furthermore, in their constitution, they don't have life imprisonment. You know, looking at it as an official here, this politically isn't that hard. In fact, when we were just down on the Texas border, I was told by an official, which is broad enough to cover all the departments so they can't find the person, that they refer to it as the North American Free Drug Trading Act because they don't know how to control the border because it's so massive and the cooperation is there. Do you have any suggestions about our ability to monitor both the southwest border as well as the Pacific and Atlantic coasts unless we can get a higher rate of cooperation?
Well, I believe that certainly you can't tackle the problem without a lot of cooperation, but there are barriers to that cooperation, and they are on both sides. On our side, it's how much information can we share at the operational level without compromising our activities. I think you will hear statements of cooperation at the highest level of government, but you must translate that down to the operational level to attack the traffickers, the organizations, to carry out seizures and so forth, and that is problematic. I am very familiar with the situation on the southwest border, and we have a major conflict there between our goals of facilitating the free movement of goods across the border and consistent with both our objectives for economic development. At the same time, it provides limitless opportunities for drug smuggling. And I've been down to the border area, and you can see the various means that people use to get the drugs into the commercial traffic and across the border.
What you're saying is very troubling, because are you saying that the two goals are mutually exclusive?
I'm not saying that they are mutually exclusive, but I do think that it represents a situation where they can come into conflict, but I don't think the country can afford to back away from either of those goals, and it's going to require much greater cooperation between the two countries to address it.
Because in Fort Wayne, I don't want the choice of whether to have kids die, people shot in the streets, gangs selling drugs for a few additional jobs. In actuality, we probably lose net jobs, but even from a national American perspective, these are tough trade-offs. I mean, some of this, when we were at Juarez El Paso border, and you see there's one free bridge backed up for hours, the pressure on those people to expedite the cars through when you don't see the lines at the bridges that have a fee, but then the pressure that goes on those agents to accelerate, or the confusion that occurs, as we heard in other border crossings, where they'll send somebody who's in effect a decoy with a light load to then slip it in because it backs up and the pressure gets on, people get upset in their cars. It's human nature then, and it limits our ability to do that. We have to have the will, I believe, which is what's lacking in your trade-off, to say either we're going to have more border crossing places with more equipment, because you've almost set up a, oh, this is a trade or drugs, but aren't there some things that we could aggressively do that could potentially get at the drugs more, even if we were going to allow the border crossings?
I agree with you. The situation along the border is very daunting. One only has to be there to see the trucks backed up for miles, to see the hard work of the drug enforcement agents and the customs people trying to make sure that drugs should not get into the country. And it is, one only has to go there to understand the task at hand. I think a preliminary kind of effort would be to enhance, through more technology and other means, the ability of our people on the border to do their job of detecting illicit drugs. There are other steps that I believe can be taken, including increasing cooperation with U.S. counterparts in Mexico. There are a number of steps that I think can be taken that would tend to ameliorate the problem, but I don't think they will fully eliminate the problem of trying to facilitate the movement of goods while at the same time trying to protect this country from the scourge of drugs.
Do you see any signs on the Mexican side of the border that they're doing things? For example, anybody driving down the highway can see we have places where trucks go over to get checked for weight. Do you see any signs that before any of their vehicles are heading towards America that they're doing any anti-drug screening, if they're committed, anything on the other side of the border crossings that show that they're committed to trying to reduce the number of narcotics coming into our side?
I am personally not aware of any effort on the parts of the Mexican government. I do know that the U.S. has a proposal or is considering some type of system of pre-clearance for trucks and the drivers that have been pre-cleared in Mexico to ease the inspection at the border. I'm not sure of the status of that. I was told that that is one of the proposals being considered and that they're testing certain technology to try to see if this will, in fact, be practical.
Do you, if you were looking at this, in your opinion, are they fully cooperating?
I'm not in a position to answer that question. What I can do is say, when you look at tangible results in terms of seizures, law enforcement activities, people who have gone to jail, there are not many very firm, tangible results that you can point to over the last couple of years.
And if I may ask one last question, that we constantly heard in almost every meeting when we were just recently in Mexico, and we heard this before, is let's don't talk about what's happened in the past. We're committed to change. Now, as Administrator Constantine said, this is the fourth round of this. And you made an allusion, Mr. Nelson, just a few minutes ago, that we have to know that our information isn't being compromised. But in fact, when they had a drug czar who was in an apartment owned by a cartel owner, and they didn't know that, and we didn't know that, and we heard it in front of this committee before, that our administration is concerned that every single piece of material had been compromised, every potential witness, every potential informant, all of our undercover agents had been compromised, and that in fact history sometimes can be a projection, sometimes it isn't a projection of what's going to happen next. But wouldn't you recommend, based on what you've seen, that to some degree history says that we should be cautious before we do too many exchanges and build on some record of success here, and it's not completely irrelevant?
Yeah, I would agree with you that you have to be cautious, but I think that the U.S. law enforcement community are very much aware of the problem, and that they tend to factor this into the level of cooperation, what they share and what they do not share, and so forth. I think the issue of corruption runs through all of the processes, all of the steps, and all of the institutions that you have to use to attack the problem.
As an auditor, if you were looking at them, and let's say we shared all of our information sources with them this year and then had problems, Wouldn't you come back here as a GAO and say, why did you share all that information given the past history?
It's a choice between making some progress and having basically an arm's length relationship. I think both countries have to work together. The endemic corruption in the institutions, I think it's going to be there. It's going to take a while. And we have to basically work to achieve what we can. But we need to stay on a course of showing some progress. I think that's where we need to establish a good game plan for attacking the problem, including giving them equipment and assistance that works, and holding the government accountable for achieving some positive outcomes as the only way of dealing with what is a long-term problem that's going to require sustained effort on the part of both governments.
Well, I thank you for your comments, and Commissioner Kushner, because there's no question what you say is true. I mean, Mexico is not going to disappear. It's clear in North America and Central and South America, unless we work together in this hemisphere in trade questions and our people moving back and forth across the borders, we have to learn how to get along. It's more a question of how fast, in what way. Did you want to?
Yes. When you look at the General Accounting Office, I have responsibility for a lot of issues that where U.S. objectives can only be achieved through cooperation and coordination with either multilateral institutions or other countries. And when you look at the range of issues we have with Mexico, I think that cooperation, sincere cooperation at all levels, is going to be required to address some of the fundamental issues that go to trade, to immigration, law enforcement, just a number of key U.S. policy objectives play out on the Mexican border, including environmental issues, labor issues, and so forth. So,
well, once again, I thank you for your testimony. There's no question from what we've heard both in the first panel and the second panel that we have a very difficult decision facing us in the House, because while we can agree on that there have been attempts to make progress, the results haven't been particularly impressive, and we need to sort through this decertification process, not because it's fun to go through, but because we're very concerned about the drug problem in this country, facing our kids, facing our families, what it's done to our country, what it's doing in corrupting Mexico, what it's doing and has corrupted Colombia in the past. We have seen success stories in Peru and Bolivia. There is no doubt that as those governments have gone after it, we've seen changes in those countries. We've seen when we've put up efforts at interdiction, we can actually reduce the flood into our country and drive the prices up, which is by driving those prices up and what they can pay by forcing them into river traffic as opposed to air traffic. We then result in the people on the ground being paid less, which means that they look for alternative crops. There are successes. We need to do more on demand reduction in our country, and we're working on that, on treatment, prevention programs, enforcement, drug testing in a variety of different forms. These are very difficult issues, but one of the fundamental questions we have to ask is, if we have a drug certification process, as I favor, as Chairman Micah originally put in as a staffer when he was over in the Senate, if we favor this and you never implement it, even when there aren't results, do you lose the effectiveness of the whole process, a process that has served us, in my opinion, well as a country, especially when, as we heard earlier in this hearing, that in fact it wouldn't cut off all trade, it doesn't cut off all assistance, and if you aren't willing to make some steps, are we really ever going to get the results? So we appreciate your participation in the hearing today and the report that you gave us. We'll leave the record open for 2 weeks for additional questions in written form and additional comments from our members. And with that, our hearing stands adjourned.
Next, a speech by National Education Association President Bob Chase. Then Republican presidential candidate Pat Buchanan,